It's already started. All right, guys, what's going on? We're here. We're live. Welcome to a brand new Poker Live podcast. We're bound to spree this week. Oh my God, who's that guy? My name's Joey Ramon, aka Chicago Joey. Joined today by for the fourth time. I think this is the fourth official podcast we've done together. Yeah. One of the favorites on the podcast. If we had to do a podcast power rankings, he's going to be at the top of the list. He's debatably the fittest man in poker. Shout out Jay Kuhn. Sean LaFour. What's up, Poppy? Hola, hola,
Molsa. Happy to be here. Excited to do another podcast.
We're happy to have you here. We tried to do this a couple times previously, and you know, I don't know, schedules, and you're obviously you're busy in the gym 26 hours a day. You're busy drinking water. Shout out to all the water I brought today for the podcast. I wanted to come prepared. Normally I drink with some guests. Today I brought a bunch of bottles of water. Unfortunately for you, I'm not going to go to the bathroom 100 times today, so I'm going to try to hold it all in and see what happens with that. So
I was thinking about you the other day because I had to use a pee bottle. Well, I used a shaker cup that I've been drinking BCAAs out of while I was playing, and I just had to pee so bad, and I had a fish. I just couldn't leave. So I peed. I filled up the entire shaker cup almost right to the top.
And when so you filled up an entire – I'm trying to think I have a shaker cup around it. You filled up an entire shaker cup to the top in one pissing.
Yeah. and then, of course, the fish left in, 3 minutes, obviously. But, so every time I pee in a cup, I think about you.
I mean, I feel like you're not the only poker player out there who thinks about me when they piss in a cup, which, I mean, I don't know if that's good or bad, but I'm happy you're thinking about me when you're peeing. You know, that's pretty good.
So, I watched the Ben 86 podcast the other day and thought it was amazing. It was really insightful. Because I've met him a couple times. He's obviously a really nice guy, really cool guy, obviously a really smart guy, but he doesn't do much social media. So it was kind of cool to see him talk about things that previously, you know, never really hear him talk about. So he's basically pretty much what I would expect, like a lot of his answers. He's clearly like a hyper analytical type person. Looking big there, Poppy. Is that just the lighting or what? You've been working out?
You say I'm looking big?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, if you believe the chat right now, they're claiming you look bigger since the last time you were on, too.
Well, I'm definitely more cut. I'm ready for summer, that's for sure. This is the most cut I've ever been, the most shredded. I actually eliminated whey protein powder from my diet. I have one of my friends, she does competitions. And she's like, yeah, I just went to get checked for intolerances the other day, and whey protein was one of my intolerances. So I thought about it, and I used to just kind of accept the fact that sometimes you look your best and sometimes you don't, and as if there were some variance and randomness involved. And then I thought about it. I was like, wait a second. When I think about all the times that I take protein powder, for the next few hours, I don't ever really look great, like my best. I'm bloated, basically. So I eliminated it from my diet, and within the first week, I was like, yeah, I'm never bloated. I'm always, tight and, basically looking my best, you know. I tried a bunch of different other protein powders. I tried vegan, hemp, something else, and they were all gross. And then finally, I went with the beef protein. It's not bad. It doesn't mix very well, but it's something. It's better than nothing. But I mean, I would prefer going with just eating solid foods if I had to than taking something that I'm slightly intolerant to. So I'm a firm believer that everybody is at least a little bit intolerant to anything that's unnatural, right? So when you're taking protein powder, you're taking something that's been isolated from milk, from dairy, and turned into just pure protein powder. It's not something that's very natural. So, you know, people that are not able to digest gluten and lactose, I think everybody is at least a little bit lactose intolerant, at least a little bit gluten intolerant, you know? You might not be having diarrhea every time you eat those things. I actually just talked about this in a fitness blog. I released the blog yesterday, just a little 8-minute one on if it fits your macros. You should check it out. Just a few little things that I've kind of learned along the way. And everybody always asks me about if it fits your macros. So I decided to just kind of spill the beans on what I thought.
Right, for those guys that haven't seen LaFort's fitness blog, it's lafortimmons.wordpress.com. He's put out about 8 videos now over time on YouTube and on his fitness blog. He wrote out a couple long blog posts as well talking about different things. He's got some about bulking. A lot of the things he's written have helped me a lot. I feel like since the first time you were on, my personal diet's completely changed. I don't drink soda ever. I pretty much drink a lot of water. I don't eat fast food ever. I eat a lot of fish. I eat a lot of nuts.
Good stuff.
I'm trying to GTO my shit up. But so, is there any way people out there that can check out for these the imbalances in our diet, or potentially like if we're having too much whey protein, or if we're having too much something in our own diets?
Yeah, I mean, basically anything that you're eating that isn't natural. So, you know, obviously meats, things that grow underground, vegetables. Nuts are natural, but like grains are a very fuzzy area, because the thing that a lot of people don't realize is that the grains that we eat now, a lot of them are genetically modified, and that's the reason why we have gluten intolerances. The grains that our ancestors eat and the grains that our bodies are designed to digest are not always very readily labeled properly, so it's not easy to always know what you're eating. But the rule of thumb is the less that's been done to the food, the better your body's going to be at digesting it. And then the next question is, okay, well, I really like ice cream and I'm a little bit lactose intolerant. What does that mean for me? And the thing is that when you're not digesting things properly, your body will tend to store things as fat if it doesn't know what to do with it. And it'll also make you feel lethargic. So those are things that obviously are not going to be good if you're trying to do something and make some changes in your physique, or get stronger, get better at basketball. So those are just kind of choices you got to make. So I would recommend, if you're really into eating a few different types of foods, like maybe you love pizza or something like that, mm-hmm. try eliminating them for a week.
No.
And see what...
No. Well, not going to be able to do it. Nope.
Hey, these are just my suggestions.
Before, I'm serious. I was talking to myself couple days ago, and I was like, I'm thinking, you know, I'm watching a LaFort video on Instagram. You know, you're doing a pull down. Doing some like flexing voice. You don't follow Instagram. If you don't follow LaFort on Instagram, well, if you like pictures of males working out with their shirts off, LaFort is your fucking guy to follow on Instagram. He's my favorite shirtless guy on Instagram.
I put artwork and stuff up there now. A lot of random other things like that.
Yeah, I don't notice. I gotta be honest, buddy. I don't notice those pictures. I just notice the videos of
It's not my style to just like post videos of myself, but a lot of people have really, because whenever I make any sort of fitness blogs and stuff, everybody's always like, yeah, that's great, but like I want to see it. Like I want to see you doing it, or like, you know, they want it. So I just started putting them up, and people seem to really like them. So,
well, hey, you just transitioned into something. During the World Series of Poker, we're gonna be taking some videos together of us in the gym. You're gonna be putting me through a LaFort workout. We're gonna be filming some other videos. I know we're gonna be spending some time at EDC Electric Daisy Carnival, and we're gonna be getting our music festivaling on together. So.
June 18th to June 28th will be the dates that I'm going to be there. So if anybody, I want to work out almost every day. So if anybody wants to join in for a workout, get at me. And because I would prefer working out with somebody than working out alone. So yeah, for sure.
Got Brian Hastings in the chat. He says, what up, LaFort? You in Vegas, bro?
What did he say?
I said, are you in Vegas? Bro.
No, but I will be, like I just said, June 18th to 28th. So Brian, we should grab a beer. It's been too long. It's been a few years, actually. I think we were in Europe last time.
Did you guys do some dancing out in Europe together, you and Brian? Did he show you his moves?
No. What did we do? No, we just hung out. We were playing the tournaments. Had some dinners or whatever.
Yeah. Kind of
nothing too crazy.
Yeah, Brian is getting his rage on this weekend. He's taking a little break from his $500,000 in side bets he has at the World Series of Poker. So, Brian, please don't kill yourself this weekend at the pool party. Please stay alive, my friend. You got a lot of money to win or lose, potentially. A couple people in the chat Wing Girl Secrets. So there's this guy on Twitter, Wing Girl Secrets. I don't know. I can't figure out what the fuck they're doing on Twitter. They're asking questions about, I don't know. But they said, holy crap, is that guy on steroid, married, or have a girlfriend? Those are quite the three interesting options that you could be.
Uh-huh.
So are you married yet, LaFort?
No, I'm not married.
Okay, not married. LaFort's not married yet, guys. You got a shot. If you want a shot, you got a shot with him. Get in touch. I know one of our biggest podcast fans, Sarah DiMaggio, is a big fan of yours, LaFort. Do you want to give her a shout-out potentially?
Sure. What's her name, sorry?
Sarah DiMaggio.
Sarah DiMaggio. Hello, Sarah. Hi.
She'll probably watch this back later and not see that. She's actually probably going to come live at some point in time. So we're going to put her back to this point in time and
sure.
And do that. So yeah, Brian said, definitely need to grab a beer. Been way too long. Come out for my birthday, June 24th. My birthday too. Yeah, we're going to go out for our...
I'll be there.
A dual birthday celebration.
Oh, man, that's great. I love how I'm going for 10 days this time, and I have, like, so many things that I want to do while I'm there, you know? Like, I'm going to play two poker tournaments, maybe, and, like, I have no intentions of playing cash games.
Same.
Just going to have a fun time, basically. That reminded me, though, I forgot to mention, I have a stalker / hacker right now, and it's kind of alarming because I was dealing with that just before... the podcast. So basically somebody has just found all of my accounts and is requesting password resets. So everything. So like Skype, Facebook, Instagram, dating sites, like a few more. They haven't gotten, like, there's been no poker stuff at all. And that email, also like the email, my Google accounts. But those emails and accounts are not associated whatsoever with my poker stuff. So, like, I'm not all that concerned about it. And secondly, like, I mean, the passwords are really random. I don't understand what they could do. But what's alarming to me is it's been, like, a week now, and it's happening daily. So I'm clearly on this person's agenda on a daily basis to, like, research, you know what I mean? So it's kind of alarming in that clearly it's some sort of lunatic. It actually started on one of the dating sites, which nobody would have associated me with, I don't think, unless they had found me on there. So part of me wonders if it's like some dude who poses as a girl on dating sites and then tries to hack into, like, finds guys that they figure are successful that they can maybe blackmail or hack into or something and find. But I don't, it seems so futile as an attempt. Like, I'm just getting emails to reset my password. I just delete the email. Like, what can they do, you know?
Well, they're probably watching this right now. Shout out to the stalkers, by the way. Listen, LaFort, I know sometimes the stalkers can bring some hardships in our life. Obviously, right now you're going through something right now. But I got a lot of love for my stalkers. Shout out to all the stalkers out there watching this right now that never respond to anything. Shout out to everybody that looks at LaFort's photos on Instagram that never likes him or never says anything to him. Just say something to him, man. Give him a hello. You don't got to try to hack his passwords. You don't got to try to take his accounts. You know, I got a lot. Do you have any other? You deal with a lot of stalkers, before, do you?
No, it's a new thing for me, but it's a little weird. I'm not sure how I feel about it.
Well, that's a good thing you haven't had many stalkers. I'd imagine a guy like you, you know, debatably the fittest man in poker, debatably one of the smartest guys in poker, might deal with some stalkers in his life. But I'm happy to see that you've been steering clear of that.
Nope, I don't have many enemies. Do my best to be friendly, make friends.
That's what I like to hear, man. I mean, we got a lot of talking points written down here. I guess we can kind of go a bunch of directions with things. We could go towards poker. We could go towards fitness, which I know everybody loves to hear from you. We could go towards the future of your life. I know it seems like, you know, poker slowly and slowly for you personally. I know it sort of declines. Yeah. So let's kind of start off with this year. What have you been doing poker-wise? How's it been going? What have you been focusing on? What have you been playing?
I've been playing predominantly heads up. Basically, I just find the Zoom games... Oh, did it freeze? No, we're good. Okay. The Zoom games, as expected, have gotten harder over time. And my issue with them is that I don't feel great playing them if they're not my main game. So when I'm playing a lot of heads-up poker, I don't feel great about just hopping into the 25-50-6-max pool. And the way it operates is you basically have five or six of the best six max regs for tabling for every one fish. That's one tabling. right? So you're basically playing against 96% of your hands are against the best players in the world at 6-max, and 4% of the time you're playing against a fish. So it's like there's not a lot of incentive. Like, and historically speaking, my 6-max results have been marginal. Like, I've been a winner playing in basically the toughest games, but it's not something that, like, I would need to put a lot more work into to make it worthwhile to spend a lot of time doing it. And I also find 6-max so stressful that eliminating it for the most part didn't really hurt me much. It just kind of made me play more mid-stakes, high, like, heads up, which I don't mind because I prefer it anyways. So that's basically where I'm at. It's just not really conducive to my lifestyle to just stress out about trying to put a lot of time into playing 6-max when it's not. It's for an amount of value that I'm okay with bypassing at this point. And I also don't see much of a future, I guess I should say, for like those specific Zoom games. Like, they're so tough, you know, like they're really, really tough. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying I don't see a future there. I don't see a future for me there. Like, I see the edges there to be very, very marginal. So it's for the types of guys that are willing to put in a ton of volume and just eke out those few big blinds over a few hundred thousand hands. And that's just, I'm kind of growing distant from that in my poker evolution, and I'm not really looking to just be at the computer every day, all day, you know? So that's where I'm at. So I've played a lot of heads up this year, mostly heads up, and it's gone well. Put in a lot of volume January, February, March, and then I kind of had like a staycation of sorts the last like 3 or 4 weeks. And this is like, it's funny because like basically the Ben 86, the first half an hour of that podcast really hit home. Like, some of the things that he talked about were all the things that I've basically been thinking a lot about over the last month. And I wanted to kind of discuss them, and I actually made some points. That's why I brought the book over to start, because I made some notes earlier today. But I realized that, like, the changes I've made are more of like a more of like an attitude, and as opposed to like making specific changes to my life. It's more of a attitude towards poker, and I'm almost in a bit of an experimental stage with how I want my life/poker balance to continue. Because I realized that the way I was living was not maximizing my potential for, I don't want to say happiness, but for my experience on a daily basis. When I stepped away from playing poker for a few weeks, I realized I was having so much fun doing other things, and it made me realize that I have less fun doing those other things when I'm in poker mode because I'm so focused on poker. So what I'm saying by that is that to play the highest stakes poker online in a particular game, you're so, and this is something, sorry, my phone's driving me nuts. This is something Ben spoke about, is that you're so involved and obsessed with this particular game, and you've put so much thought and energy and emotion and power and value into this, you know, playing these games, that it kind of makes you exhausted for other areas of life. Mm-hmm. And when you're in that poker mode and you're just, you know, wake up today, battle Ravenswood 51, you know, wake up tomorrow, battle Ike, you know, 51, and play the toughest 6-max games the next, and you're just like, and then the next day it's like, okay, I'm golfing with my buddies. And I used to think that, yeah, that's a fine lifestyle, and that's totally fine. But I've realized that when I was out golfing with my buddies, I was only like 75% there because I was still in the poker mode. Like, I was still thinking about what I was going to do tomorrow poker-wise, or I was still I was lacking the skill to kind of separate the two. I used to think I did an RNA job with it, but I really think by stepping away from the game for a few weeks, it kind of made me realize that I need to do a better job of balancing those lifestyles. And unfortunately, I've kind of come to the conclusion that It means playing less poker, and it means being less emotionally and energetically involved, in a sense. I think we only have a certain capacity as human beings to be present in all the things we're doing. And if you're kind of wasting that all on poker because you're just maximizing your dollar EV at poker, I think you really miss out on a lot of other things in life. And I think that's kind of the path I was following. And I kind of saw that in some of Ben's podcasts. And I have a feeling that he's kind of hinting towards having some of those same realizations in the things when he said, yeah, I need to work at that. I need to work at my social life. I need to get better at, you know, being in the present when I'm on a date with a girl because I was just playing high stakes and like stuff like that he spoke about. So, yeah, sorry, I've been rambling about some stuff here, but these are the types of things that I've been thinking about and kind of it's tough. Like, it's kind of a weird moment in time to have this podcast because I'm really in the middle of just thinking about these things and I haven't really come to strong conclusions. But that's kind of where I'm at poker-wise from a general standpoint. I mean, I've still been playing here and there over the last couple weeks, but it's been I'm basically waking up and thinking, like, how do I want to enjoy today? You know, if poker is there, that's fine. If poker's part of that, that's fine. If it's not, it's not. In an isolated sense, I still really love playing poker. But in a more macrocosmic balanced lifestyle, I'm trying to do a better job of playing the right amount. You know, that makes sense?
That makes sense. I guess that you also sort of start feeling this way once you have a certain level of success at poker that you can now afford. Yeah. You know, you can afford to not necessarily be all in at poker. You can afford to look this place or look that place or try to figure out a way to, you know, be more, I guess, I don't even know if balance is quite the word right now. It's more of like, now you're trying to figure out, you know, how can I be more happy? How can I live more optimally for myself?
Yeah.
But I think a lot of people out there probably, you know, aren't in a position necessarily that are especially trying to make it at poker. They're not really in the position to be like, all right, like I'm going to try to put less into poker. Cause what happens with that is your skill level deteriorates, your potential win rate starts to, you know, get lower and lower. The overall amount of money hourly you make is going to decline.
Yes.
So I guess you've kind of decided that you're fine with that happening, or you feel like that is necessarily going to happen to you in terms of your overall skill level dropping. You think it'll still stay at it's going to stay at a high level, but do you think it can still stay at the best where you can battle the Hollywood hacks of the world?
I do think so, because I mean, ultimately I'm going to be playing a little bit less poker. And I feel as though I'm going to be fresh when I'm playing, for one. And for two, I just feel as though I'm going to be a little more passionate about it when I am playing as well. Like, I'm going to be more in the moment when I'm playing. I guess, like your point about not everybody being that position is relevant, but I think it's also important to point out that everybody's situation is relative, and what I've learned, especially in the last 6 months, is I've done a lot of I'm trying to become more zen, I guess. I've done a lot of I've been meditating every day, and that's really brought a lot of interesting things to my attention, and I think for some of those guys, maybe they're making $100,000 a year playing poker and they're incredibly obsessed and putting all their energy and passion and emotion into being able to make $300,000 a year in poker, when they don't realize that making that extra $200,000 may not impact their lives as strongly as they think it might. And I think sometimes it's important to be it's important to appreciate what you do have and what you are making. And the fact that because you make $100,000 without having a job, that does let you enjoy the weather today because it's a beautiful day, so take the day off work. You know what I mean? Because if you're so focused on poker and you're not enjoying these other things, what is it all worth? Like, why, like, what's $5 million if you don't enjoy it? If you don't use the luxury of what, no, and I don't even mean material goods. I just mean the security of not having to work. Or the security of being free. You know, it's like the Dan Bilzerian theorem. You know, he doesn't value being rich for what a lot of other people value it for. He values it simply for his freedom. You know, by being one of the richest guys around, it means he's one of the freest guys around. He can do whatever the heck he wants, right? So I realized that if you're so chained to this idea of being at this certain level of poker, you're not really free because you're chained to this poker lifestyle. You know what I mean? And in a sense, you see it a lot. I tend to see that a lot when I hang out with a lot of other poker players, like especially the World Series, when guys have schedules of like playing 40 events and stuff, and they're so engulfed in like the poker bubble, you know? And it's like, some of these guys are really wealthy, not all of them, but some of them, and it's like, you wouldn't even know. Like they have nice clothes, but they're not necessarily, you know, they're still spending the whole day in the Rio for 3 days straight, you know? Is that really the way you want to do things? But
all right, so Dan Bilzerian theorem, which I didn't know he had a theorem, but it's always like idea, and about yourself too. So the common denominator in those things is that they already have success. You have this money to sort of live that way. But what do you think about the idea of that you sort of sacrifice those things right now? How are you, so if you live this way as you're climbing up, you're trying to have the success, you're trying to make this amount of money, well, you might not actually get up here to be able to happily live this balance. You might be stressed out with money or any sort of way of like that. But yeah. What about sacrificing for a period of time with the understanding that once you reach a certain level of success, having the confidence that you're going to reach that point, once you get up there, well, then you can take a step back and be like, all right, now I maybe need to realize that, okay, I want to have more happiness here. But in the meantime, I might be sacrificing some of this overall happiness for a greater long-term happiness.
Right. Yeah, totally understand what you're saying. But what you have to be very careful of with thinking that way is that if you're trying to get up to there, what exactly is there? And if you have this attitude that you always want to get up to there, oftentimes what ends up happening is you get there and then there's a new there.
Mm-hmm.
And then this is basically this whole realization that I've kind of had in the last year of my life, and it runs rampant in Toronto. Like Toronto's got to be the worst city in the world for it. Everybody is trying to get there, and nobody is enjoying it here. You know what I mean? And the key is that if you're trying to get there, that's fine, but don't do it by neglecting here. You know? And that's kind of what a lot of meditation has really helped me do. Is it's helped me just enjoy the moment, enjoy the things that I do have. Have that passion to achieve what you want to achieve, but don't blind yourself from enjoying what you already have. And I feel like that tends to be the behavior of a lot of people. Is they aspire to be something, and they have this attitude of always aspiring to level up, essentially. And without realizing that when they reach that next level, they're still having the same attitude. They want to level up. And everybody, they're focused on leveling up all the time instead of enjoying the level they're on, you know?
I guess that happens. I think you have to reach a certain level. I mean, if we're talking from like a level up perspective, you kind of have to reach a certain level before you have the luxury. I mean, some people, I think a lot of people, especially in poker. So if we're associating this with poker specifically.
Yeah.
I think, I mean, realistically, there's 85% of people who probably don't have that luxury to sort of not put their all into poker, really. Because, I mean, when you think about how many successful poker players out there, you know, weren't putting their all into it at the time, I don't know many, not many people I know sort of came up that way and got to the ultimate level that they wanted to get to.
Right.
So, you mentioned once you hit this point, you always want to hit that point. And I guess that's true to some point. It's once you're there. But I feel like most smart people, eventually, they do reach a point, and then they can kind of take a step back. In general, not everyone always wants to keep moving higher and higher. But I guess in a big city, though, those tend to be the kind of people. When I was in San Diego, those are the kind of people I met for sure. It was,
yeah,
the level, that kind of thing. So,
yeah, I guess basically to kind of conclude this kind of topic or concept is what I've learned is even if you are one of those poker players that's just kind of getting by and paying the bills, don't let your aspirations stress you out to the point where you're not enjoying your current life because you're so focused on trying to get to the next level. You know, release the idea that you're going to die if you don't reach the next level. I've got to plug in my computer. Okay. So basically what I'm saying is, like, that's fine. You can set those goals and you can put everything into it, and maybe it's very necessary for you to do that, but just make sure that you're enjoying the journey, you know? Otherwise, it's not even worth getting to that next level, you know? I got to plug in my computer before it goes.
We'll get some shout-outs, guys, now that LaForce got to plug your computer. Luke Armstrong, what's up, Luke? Jonathan Rubio, what's up, Jonathan? Tyler Short, Balky Balky, P-Man 86, what's up, P-Man? I saw Arnie in here. Matilda, what's up, Matilda? What's up, Arnie? Greg Wiseman, Deep House, P. Dando, Nigel Jones, Ludwig, Tender, Kush. What's up, Kush? Kush Strain. I don't know if that can't be your name. That's probably a drug reference. Michael, Lead Him. Knipen, asking weird questions as always. Liquors, Matt Bush, Costa, Fosfos, Daniele, GTO Plays. What's up, Eddie? AP. I was going to call you Buddy, Baby, Poppy, but I couldn't think of which word I was going to get out there. JMD, Voldy, Marcus, what's up, Marcus? Billy, Marco, Papi, hola, colamos, Papito, Show of Force, what's up, buddy? I froze up temporarily. LaForte's plugging in his laptop right now, but I want to remember in my mind what he just said because I had something to add to the point he just made, so. Tender says he planned that he could get up and show us exactly how jacked he is right now. Appreciate the long game. What's up, Martin Vanderhost, Puppy? No shout out on Happy Face. I'm sorry, man. I hate to miss the shout outs for everybody. A the Great, Mads. What's up, Mads? Klunkavid. What's up, Puppy? Balky Balky, 1986. Ball Balky. Cesar Contreras, Puppy. Arn Skedjabredebreder. Joey says my name. Much love, man. Snap triple and 33. I'm not. I hope you guys watching right now are taking advantage of the podcast Run Good that comes. LaForte's computer died. What the hell did he just say? I gotta go back to the point he just made because I was gonna disagree at this point. So he said that in real time, once you're grinding up, you should work more at enjoying the time there, because once you get to that point that you're trying to get to, you won't even enjoy it, which I'm gonna strongly disagree with. Because, I mean, I can only speak from personal experience on that thing, but yeah. Alex Gonzalez, what's up, Puppy? I think I might have shouted everybody out in the chat right now. Fast. Joey asked about investing, was very interesting last time. We'll definitely get to some investing things. Aiden Haynes, what's up, Aiden Puppy? Show of Force, what's up, man? I can't believe Sarah DiMaggio is missing this podcast, guys. She comes into every chat, and LaForte was her favorite guest that she wanted to see. And now she's not here. So, yeah, I'm assuming LaForte's got to re-plug his computer in. He's going to have to recharge it. And I'm sure you guys are – he has computer died 1 minute. He'll be back in, he says, according to Skype. Boom. So, yeah, Tonio, what's up, Tonio, Puppy? I saw your messages, your other message you sent me, Tonio, on Facebook. I'll respond to you after the podcast, my friend. Brandon D says, LaForte is saying from his view, since he's already passed the super grinding part of life. I definitely agree, Brandon. I definitely agree. I think a lot of these things are much easier to have the epiphanies and outlooks once you reach a level of success. But I don't necessarily think that they're even wrong to think that way. I think that, you know, that's another part of life, the grind up. And then once you get there, it's about how to maximize your time when you get to that point too. So. Arnie says, wow, butchering would be an understatement of what you just did with my name, but I love you still. Yeah, dude. I don't know how to pronounce name. I mean, I do know how to pronounce names, but at this point, I don't even try anymore because I usually fail at it anyway. Danny B, what's up, Danny B? Mr. Selva, what's up, Puppy? Papito, Papinga, Palacola Mosa. Mark Broderson says, just subbed. Awesome content. Thank you, Mark. Yeah, guys, I got a lot of podcasts on the channel if you're first time people. A lot of great guests. I do some PLO stuff, a lot of rails. I have some upcoming World Series of Poker content I'm going to be releasing to try to make the World Series of Poker a little bit more fun for all the people that like my stuff to follow along with. That'll be cool. Vincent Vega, what's up, buddy? He says, what up, Joe? Glad to be watching this. Thank you very much. LXYU says, first time. I'm loving it. What's up, buddy? Max Henning says, sup, Joey? What stakes do you actually play? I haven't followed you from the beginning. Max, right now I play mid and high stakes PLO. I've been playing 2-4 to 10-20 PLO now for the past, I don't know, man, 4 years, something like that. So, yeah, still actively participating in those streets. D-Seep, what's up, buddy? One life, one love. Welcome, welcome. The Tender says, can we break the podcast record for length today? We might be able to. I was going to go to a concert later tonight with some 20-year-old girls, but I decided that would not be GTO. And by that, I mean, I don't know what, I can't actually tell you what I decided. Ed Victoria, what's up, buddy? TJ, what's up, TJ, puppy? P. Dando says, am I back home? Well, P. Dando, I'm going to have you do some detective work, my friend, to figure out if I'm back home. That's a great question. I'm going to look around and see if I can notify some. I don't know, man. I can't answer that question for you. You got to answer that question for yourself. I'm teaching you guys how to be detectives here. Wing Girl Secret says, it's a great, interesting interview. It should be mandatory that the tournament players that post on Twitter 2+2 should have to watch how a true professional handles himself. Now, I'm not going to take any shots at tournament players during this podcast, but I think the average type of conversation you might have with a tournament player and what you might have with somebody like Lafort might be slightly different, for sure. Max Hennig says, love your podcast. Thanks, Max. Much fucking love, baby. Much love. Espen Thompson. What's up, Espen Thompson? Thompson? Espen Thompson? What's up, Joe? What's up, baby? Puppy. Darius Zimmerman says, just ordered a podcast after a crazy lurk workout, and now I get the live stream. Welcome, welcome. A the Great says, thought you played 1020 plus. 1020 plus doesn't really run much more in any sites, unfortunately, A the Great. So the level of 1020, I feel comfortably playing on, I guess, above 1020. The level of comfort I have playing on some of these sites is not very high. There are very evil things happening on some sites, basically. So especially in 6-max games. Liquor says, best podcaster with PLO players IMO. I mean, I would just, maybe. I don't know, man. I think a lot of the tournament guys are pretty cool, too. So, Lafort, you're back. Welcome.
Hey, buddy. Sorry about that. Yeah, my computer just, like, died.
You kind of look, you look like Ryan Reynolds. I've noticed this as I've been staring at your face.
I get that. I get Ryan Reynolds. I get Brody Jenner. Jody Brenner. Brody Jenner. It depends on, like, the where my hair is at. If my hair is at different stages. And I also get Keanu Reeves from time to time.
I could see that. I think more Ryan Reynolds for me. I don't know, man. You look, yeah. Ryan Reynolds is a, you know, he's an attractive dude, man. You what?
I'm okay with those.
A couple more comments. I was doing crazy shots in the chat. Jay Nandez. What's up, Jay Nandez, a.k.a. Businessman? We got to get Jay Nandez back on our podcast very soon. Jay Nandez, he says, happy to see the fittest man back. Much love. P-Man says, can you Izzledrum back, maybe? And is Barry Sweet Martonis? He's not. But yeah, let's get back at it. So you mentioned one point, which was before we left, which you said that – can I elaborate? I can't. You said that you should try to enjoy the rise up, because once you get to that point, you might not enjoy it because you're not used to enjoying yourself, sort of thing. Is something like that? Is that what you said, basically, right?
Yeah, pretty much. I think happiness is just kind of a state of enjoying the things that you have. But if you just always have this attitude that, and it's human nature, you know, the successful people are often successful because they're so driven to get better at things, you know? And the thing is that if you put all of your passion into always wanting to be at a next level, whether you quantify that with money or whatever, then you're designing a lifestyle that's not going to be happy in the level that you're on, because you're not, I don't want to keep saying the same things, but essentially,
right, yeah. Yeah. I mean, I guess I can only speak from personal experience, because I know for me in real time when I was grinding at poker, I definitely sacrificed in the moment happiness with the realization that at some point, once I reach a level of success, that I'd be able to then maximize that time and I'd be able to do all these types of things I really couldn't imagine I did. So I think for me personally, once I reached that point, I was able to really maximize my own happiness and sort of enhance my life past the point. And but in real time during the grind, obviously, I hated things. I, you know, it wasn't fun. It certainly wasn't EV plus in terms of overall life happiness.
Right. Yeah. And I think that's perfectly fine and perfectly reasonable. Like, I'm not saying that that's a bad thing to do. And I think really, all I've really done is kind of had the same experience as you. Like, I've just put in my time for a lot of years, and I'm just kind of at the point where I only want to put in that time if I feel like putting in that time, basically. You know, I'm no longer willing to sacrifice the momentary pleasure or happiness of life for the sake of, you know, my future, I guess. It's kind of the best.
What would you recommend to people out there? So let's say, I know we got a lot of guys watching, striving to make it. They're putting in the hours. They're putting in the work. They're trying to get better. What would you recommend for those guys to, you know, get to a point that they dream of getting to one day?
I mean, a lot of it just comes down to whether they're enjoying themselves. I think it's just important to make sure that you're, if you are not enjoying yourself, like you said, that you were not, you know, I assume when you're doing like prop bets and stuff like that, make sure that it's at least you understand the scope of what you're doing, why you're doing it, how long it's going to take. You know, you might say, don't get caught into a rut where 5 years go by and you're now 33 years old and you're not where you want to be and you didn't enjoy the last 5 years, you didn't get to where you want to be, and you're just miserable. And you know, like, what I'm saying is that at least if you change your attitude, you can enjoy the moment, even if you're not the richest guy in the world, even if you're just getting by. You know, that doesn't change the fact that you can be present when you're actually living your day-to-day life instead of always being so obsessed with getting to 25, 50 or whatever your next level up is. You know,
I think what I found from living back around near home where I grew up is that you can have these, the only way, like, a lot of people really think this way is once they have money. Once, because so many people, I mean, whether better or for worse, they just stress about money so much. And I mean, I talk to a ton of people around here, people that I meet, people at the gym playing basketball. And I mean, you pretty much hear the same thing, is that everyone's stressed out about money somehow, whether they got a family or themselves, they're always trying to get it. They're stressed out about getting it, stressed out about how little of it they have in the current moment in time.
Yeah.
And I don't know. Yeah, I guess that's it. So I feel like, do you meet a lot of people who maybe aren't successful from a monetary standpoint, but also sort of have these, I guess, outlooks on life?
That's a good question. I do, but not in Toronto. Typically, I find when I meet people in Toronto that are from the West Coast, they very often have a much more, in my opinion, balanced understanding of what they want out of life. And it's not reaching the next level. It's not getting that next career improvement or getting that next car. It's living a balanced lifestyle, you know. They always get made fun of. The West Coast always gets made fun of for being the nature, you know, yoga type people. But I think that's kind of a reflection of, maybe I shouldn't say West Coast. I haven't really spent much time in like California and stuff, but I assume it's very similar. I mean, it might be a little tainted by how materialistic Hollywood can be, but I know people from Vancouver tend to be quite chill that I've encountered. Even successful ones as well, but I guess that doesn't really prove the point you're trying to make. But I think you're right. I think when one of the best lessons that I've learned by being self-reflective after being successful and having money is making the realization that the money itself isn't what makes me happy on a day-to-day basis. And I think that's what's helped me release from the idea of needing to just keep adding to a pile of money as if that's what life is about, you know. And it's just, you know, I and for for anybody wondering, like, when I say all these things, I'm not leaving poker. Like, my game plan was to play X amount of hands this year, and I'm probably going to play, you know, 65% or more of what I plan on playing. I just mean I'm not necessarily as driven, as focused. Like, I was always trying to maximize everything, right? So an example of this is, like, I would try to schedule my day around maximizing the number of hours that I can play poker, but not even play poker, but just be accessible for, you know, fish sitting or being around, rush to do my groceries, because if I rush, then I can come home and have a few hours before I want to go to bed to be on the computer. Or I would not join friends that out of the blue tell me they're going for drinks, because I know that there's this guy that might sit me at 10:20 this evening. Or, like, basically those life sacrifices are the types of things that I'm trying to no longer sacrifice, I guess I should say. But maybe we should talk about something else. It's been a while being on this topic.
I think it's an interesting topic. I mean, I got to be honest. I don't live for money anymore, too. But like I said, once you get to have money, you don't live for money anymore. Because yeah. I definitely agree with a lot of things you're saying. And I pretty much, I mean, I approach my sort of life now from a very similar standpoint, too. But I know a lot of people watching this are going to hear these things, and they're going to be like, you know, I try to be realistic with people, too. And I don't necessarily think a lot of people are ever going to – I know a lot of people, you know, they dream about being a high-stakes player in poker. They dream about doing well at poker, whether it's about money or it's about getting to that level. But I don't think realistically for most people, if they adopted these type of ideas – I just don't know if they could do it. I don't think it'd be possible. And I know a lot of people that watch this are poker players who have these dreams and aspirations. So I'm just, yeah. That's why I'm asking these questions, because I'm curious what you think the answers to the questions are for people that are watching who are grinding up right now.
I do think that it's possible that I could have basically reached the same level of poker success as I've had by doing a better job of enjoying other areas of my life along the way, and I don't think it would have been that much. It's just, I think I was just overextending myself in certain ways, and just pulling back a little bit is kind of really, I've realized it just makes my life so much better. You know, putting 80% of my effort into things as opposed to 100%.
I guess other hobbies outside of poker right now. I know you're obviously big into working out. You're big into lifting weights. Have you picked up any other hobbies since in the past this year, since you've had some more time outside of poker?
Not really. I mean, I do a lot of stuff, right? Like I play hockey twice a week. I play golf at least once a week in the summertime, and you know, tennis here and there. A lot of sports stuff. I really make an effort now to commit to, like, I used to be very flaky and flighty, and it's funny because I hate those people now that I'm no longer like that, because I realize how bad it is to be like that. So somebody would invite me to something, and I'd say, yeah, okay, like, yeah, I'll probably be there, you know, that's cool, or maybe, you know, whatever, and then, like, wait until the day of to decide, because, well, maybe I didn't get much poker in this week, and I want to play poker tonight. Or maybe something else comes along, and it's like, I try. Whenever I get invited to things now, I just go. Like, even if I know it's something that I'm not super excited about, just go, because, like, it's making connections with people and spending time with people, that I've realized is what makes me feel like I'm living a complete lifestyle and a balanced lifestyle. Like, when it's Thursday and I realize I haven't seen anybody since Sunday because I've just been playing poker and going to the gym every day for the last 4 days, that's the type of cycle and lifestyle that I really try to avoid. So I'm kind of, you know, I'm very, like, even today, like, a girl came up to me at the gym and was like, hey, are you any good at hockey? I was like, yeah. Like, I kind of know her a little bit. And she's like, I'm putting together this thing where every Sunday we're going to play road hockey, like, co-ed for fun, me and, like, my brothers and blah, blah, blah. And that's something that, like, even in the moment in my head, I was like, oh, that's, like, not going to be that fun, but whatever. But, like, It will be. I just need to commit and go, and I'll meet new people. It'll be fun. Like, whatever. Just go. Like, it's something to do, you know? And those are the types of things that I think, because I was so caught up in poker, I was kind of neglecting certain things. And I've just kind of opened myself up to the opportunity to live a more balanced lifestyle that way, I guess. Those are kind of little tidbits of examples of what I'm talking about, I think.
Kind of sounds like I went through a stage a couple of years ago where I was like, all right, I'm going to stop saying no to everything. I'm going to stop being obsessed with poker and playing poker all the time. And I was like, I'm going to say yes to anything that comes up. Is that similar kind of what you're doing? You're just, I mean, not anything, but you know, but you know,
yeah.
You get an OGG coming at you, you know, you might want to say, you might. And by the way, shout out to the Fork for getting approached by a girl at the gym, because that shit's rare, man. That's like a unicorn right there. But shout out to the Fork for doing that. Big ups to him. But yeah, so you're kind of saying yes to things, basically, when people are coming at you with ideas.
Yeah, absolutely. And just, just making more of an effort for those. Because I think, like, I've kind of, because I grew up as an only child, right? And when you do that, you do spend a lot of time on your own. And I was very content with being on my own and being independent. And poker has been great in that regard, in that I don't mind that solitude. But just because you're content with something doesn't mean that it's a good way to live your life, you know? And I think that was kind of the realization that I had, is that, sometimes there's, like, awkward situations where you go play road hockey with a bunch of strangers, and it's kind of weird. But those are the moments in life that you remember and have and carry into, you know, friendships and other things. And if you're just kind of living this in your own bubble where you're just playing poker and just hanging out with your friends or just going to hockey or just doing this, it's I was kind of limiting my life experiences, I think, by doing that. And now I'm just a little more open to, doing other things. Even, like, traveling. Like, if somebody were to be like, hey, I'm going to Brazil next month, you know, you want to come? You know, if you asked me that last year, it would be like, there's zero chance. Like, I want to get in a certain number of hands next month. I want to make sure I hit my quota. But now it's like, you know, 30 years old. How many more chances am I going to have to go to Brazil? Like, let's fucking go to Brazil, you know? So just trying to seize opportunities, I guess you could say.
Yeah. I think you mentioned experiences you get from saying yes or being open to things. I mean, I definitely personally had some life experiences I never would have had in my life if I would have said no. For instance, I never would have lived in Australia. If I was, because the only reason I lived in Australia was because I was like, I'm saying yes to everything. I wouldn't have went to Belgium. I never would have found my first music festival. I never would have done all these things had I had that same mindset. And it's weird. I changed the mindset 1 week, and then this all happened within a week and a half too. And I was like, you know, well, what if I've been saying yes to things for a while? But I also got myself into some trouble. I might have had too much fun.
Yeah.
I said yes for about 4 or 5 months, and I unfortunately put myself in a bad spot. So you got to be controlled on the yes, guys. If you're saying yes to things out there, you gotta be controlled. Control yourself. Have that discipline to say no to certain things.
Yeah, that's fair. Yeah. What else have we got to talk about? I feel like I don't have the chat open.
Mm-hmm.
So for all I know, like, people think that everything we've been talking about is kind of boring. So I don't even know.
I mean, if they do, they can leave. They don't have to stay. You know, that's their option as listeners. They don't enjoy the conversational topic is. They can
that's
go.
True. But I want to keep the people happy. I'm not sure what type of topics they want to be talking about. So,
well, I think that whole entire thing right there is a good topic. And I mean, obviously, things like that aren't specific poker strategy, but like I always say on here, a lot of things you can learn from. And I think having people listen to that, hear your outlook on things, I think they can think about that for themselves and figure out a way to potentially add that type of thought process into their own way and better themselves in a couple different ways. I had to give somebody a ban in the chat for saying some crazy stuff. I'm sorry.
Can I see the chat? How do I see the chat?
Before we'll let you see the chat. Let you see the chat, buddy. Here, I'm going to send you a link right now. Go to the chat. Mute the audio, and then you can see the chat. The chat's distracting, though.
Mute the audio?
Well, mute the audio in the chat. When you click on the video, this audio is gonna play too. So you gotta hit the mute on the audio, and then the video will still, or pause the video too.
How's that? That's cool. Like a
yeah,
I'm muted. Holy shit, Brody Jenner. Okay.
Welcome to the chat. LaForte's in the house in the chat, guys. He's reading the chat right now.
Ryan Reynolds looks like LaForte. I like that one.
You're far behind in the chat for sure. A couple, we'll get a couple hard-hitting questions from my friend Barry Sweet, who wanted me to ask you. Would you rather do a spelling bee for roles with Ike Hollywood Haxton, or would you rather do vodka shots for roles against Zygmunt? And you had to pick one.
Wow. I guess, like, is that implying that Ike's really good at spelling?
We're just going to assume Ike's good at spelling, but because, I mean, it's Hollywood, you know?
I feel like, I mean, if Hillary, just because people are notoriously drunk and outrageously funny when they're drunk doesn't necessarily mean that they drank a lot to get there, you know? And I definitely can drink a lot now. Like, it takes a lot for me to get really, really sloppy. Like, I don't think I've been super drunk for, like, years. So probably, I think I could get Hillary there, I think. Hillary? I never know how to say his name.
Okay. So yeah. Would you rather go on a dinner date with Natalie Portman, a.k.a. Natalie326 on PokerStars, or would you rather go on a GTO strategy date with Sauce1234 and Ben86?
I mean, Ben's a friend of mine. He lives in the city, so I could just hang out with him anyways. But so I guess the clear answer is going on a date with Greek Natalie Portman. Or is it Greek or Portuguese? Or
She's from Israel, my friend.
Israel. Is Natalie Portman actually have Israeli background?
She is born in Israel. Her country of origin on her PokerStars account is Israel as well.
Okay. All right.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and last one. Would you rather have to six table Cobus heads up for 1 hour every day, or never getting to play more than one table at once?
Am I six tabling Cobus heads up?
You're six tabling Cobus heads up, correct.
I'll take that option. I don't even know what the other option was, but I'll take that one.
Okay, so you have to six table Cobus heads up every day. Those are a couple of the Barry Sweet questions that he had for me to ask you when I said ask me some questions for LaForte.
I feel like, can Barry Sweet do a podcast where he's just like, you know, no screen and like a fake voice or whatever?
I could ask him that. I feel like he might be able to do that.
Because that would be fun. Because like, yeah, there's just he's certainly one of the biggest enigmas in the poker world.
I agree. He is. He's very mysterious. He's actually not, I mean, he's not that mysterious, but he is mysterious to most people in the poker world, so.
I think he's really fucking mysterious.
Yeah.
I don't really know a lot about what's going on.
Barry Sweet. Barry Sweet is, I don't know, man. We're going to get him. I'm going to ask him if he wants to do that. A podcast where he has a voice changer and he has no video on, and we'll see what he says.
I'm just, checking out the questions now.
I told you it's distracting, LaForte. I told you it's distracting when you read the chat, man. I'm telling you, you got to be a pro at it, man. You got to be a pro at reading the chat. You got the notes. You got the chat. You got
I'm not good enough for it, so I'm going to let you take care of the chat and let me know if there's any questions or stuff to talk about.
So for upcoming Vegas here, I know you. What else do you have planned besides your workouts every day and maybe playing a couple poker tournaments?
I mean, EDC, obviously. And there's just, like, a bunch of people I haven't seen in a while. I mean, like, Brian is a good example. Let's grab a beer, whatever, you know, the party, 24th. A bunch of people I haven't seen in a while that were, you know, on the same basis. I'd really like to hook up with Jay Kuhn while we're there to grab a beer or work out. I've had a few other people message me that they want to meet up. And that's not even including the fact that I've got a lot of really good friends who are going to be there and going to be doing stuff throughout the time that I'm there. So yeah, I mean there's also more like girlfriends and stuff now there that are, because my group of poker friends is obviously aging by a year every year, they're no longer like 24-year-old single bachelors that are just raging at the Rhino on the weekend. It's like they brought their girlfriends or fiancés or whatever, and now there's more of like a little more sophistication towards the series and like what people are actually doing. Maybe the odd dinner, maybe a scheduled night where people are going out. So that happens a little more often now than it might have before. Yeah, there'll be stuff going on. I have a feeling somebody I know is going to win something, so I can see. I'm looking forward to that celebration.
How do you intend to balance your time there? Obviously, you got a lot of things to do, a lot of people to hang out with, a lot of options. What's your approach to it?
Make sure I get in a workout every day and get busy, meet people, go have fun. That's just really all I really want to do.
Yeah, so there's no other science you got behind it. You're just going to kind of, whatever comes to you that day, you're going to go ahead and do?
Yeah, I mean, it's a vacation for sure. I mean, like when I get there, I think the first 3 days are EDC, so that's obviously going to be fun. For anybody that can't see, Joey's got a big, like, shit-eating grin on his face. He's very excited about EDC, I can tell.
That's going to be fun. It's going to be a fun time, I'm pretty sure.
And then, like, a couple days after is, like, I think it's the 3K 6-max. And then a few days
One day after EDC is the 3K 6-max, the Monday.
Yeah, so, I mean, ideally, I'm on to day two of that event. And then a few days later is like the 10K PLO, so I'm definitely playing that. And I guess like I didn't even realize there's a 25K PLO this year. That's pretty sweet. So I actually scheduled my trip without including it because I didn't even know it existed. But now that that's there, what I might do is like decide while I'm there, pending how the first two events go, whether to play the third. Not so much whether I do well, but just how the fields are. Like, I'm also like, I think when you're really, really good at PLO, the difference between a 6-max tournament and a 10-handed tournament as far as your EV goes is like huge.
Well, technically they're 8-handed, so the 10K and the 25K are 8-handed.
Okay, I guess 8-handed is better than 9-handed, but even so, those two extra positions actually make a significant difference. Not so much directly to your EV, but also just how other people are playing. I won't get into details, but typically their mistakes become less bad when the table is 8-handed. Yeah, so we'll see. If the 25K PLO was like 4-handed or 5-handed, I'd just like 100% be playing it, but we'll see.
Yeah. For EDC, I know we were having a discussion the other day about this. And, you know, I have to ask you about this on the podcast too. So I said, you know, hey, at EDC, you know, you got to take your shirt off for a little bit of the podcast, right? And what did you say to me when I said that to you, buddy?
What did I say? I think I said that I'd take off my shirt if you promised to wear a GoPro helmet.
Okay, so we're going to back up because that came after it. Okay, so I said to you, hey, why don't you take your shirt off while we're at EDC?
Okay.
And you said, no, we got to leave a little mystery for the people. Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then I reminded you that your Instagram main photo is you shirtless with no face. Your Twitter avatar is you shirtless again. The photos you post on social media are all you in a tank top and or no shirt. But at EDC, you decide that's not, you're not going to be able to do it there. You got to have a shirt at EDC because you want to leave some mystery for people. Doesn't make sense. Can you?
No, there's no logic to that whatsoever. You caught me in a logical conundrum.
So you're going to be taking off your shirt at EDC is what you're saying then.
I guess I have to now. I guess I have to.
I just want to walk around with you and see you with your shirt off, then how people react to it. I just want to see. I have to see that for like 20 minutes. I just want to see what the looks are. Like, I want to see the girls' eyes if they're just like they lose their clothes. I mean, they're not wearing many clothes there already, but do they lose their clothes? I'm just curious how it works.
You know, what was really funny is I went grocery shopping last night, and it was singles night at the grocery store.
What?
I swear to God. So I go like, and I'm literally like, I have like a half an hour to bang out my groceries before I'm going to dinner. So I go in there with a list, and this guy who's like flamboyantly gay, very like overly friendly almost, like gives me this stuff, like a bag and a glass of like something, and is like, enjoy your singles night. And I'm like, where am I right now? So I go into the grocery store, and there's just like all these people standing around in the produce section, like not really shopping, just kind of mingling. And I'm like, what the fuck's going on right now? And I walk in, and like I got a lot of looks from people, because it was a very weird crowd there. Like, it was almost like a, I mean, what type of person goes to a singles night at a grocery store? So I think, and I walk in wearing a tank and like a hat on. Some of these people are wearing like a polo, and I'm just like, hey, what's up? Like, I'm just, people are like looking or whatever. And then I just tried to be polite and was like, anytime a girl asked me or said something, I was like, I'm sorry, I'm just here to get my groceries. But yeah, kind of, yeah, it was fun.
So what, you didn't want to hang out, maybe meet some people, maybe have some fun? Maybe say yes to some encounter, I mean.
Yeah, absolutely, you got me. I had other plans. I already had my fun planned for that night. I had other plans, so I couldn't renege on those fun plans for these.
Fun plans.
Fun plans. But maybe next singles night at the Metro, I'll get in the mix.
Yeah, some believe it said, haven't we talked about the grocery store grind before? And we have talked about grinding at the grocery store. The grocery store in a big city is a huge plus EV place to meet women or meet people in general. I mean, we ran some Sims in San Diego when we lived there, and it turned very plus EV, correct? Yeah.
Yeah, I can see that. I've never done it. I've never, ever. I'm kind of focused when I'm at the grocery store. You know, I've got my agenda. I know what I'm getting and where I'm getting it. Yeah, but I can see that for sure.
Nigel Jones says, Joey, can you ask LaFord, is he into any martial arts at all, or is his, or what are his main reasons for wanting to look like a god?
Definitely not into martial arts. Not that I'm not into it. It's just one of those things that I never really was exposed to much as a kid, and now that I'm older, I kind of associate it with like getting injured, you know. Like I can't imagine being into hardcore and jiu-jitsu without having like nagging injuries all the time. Maybe that's not the case. Like, I really don't know, but or just like, you know, I've had friends that get into kickboxing or what's the Muay Thai or what's the one with, yeah, Muay Thai. And they just like always have bruises on their legs and stuff like that. And like, I mean, that's, I don't know. I just would prefer to, I just enjoy going to the gym for aesthetics. It's kind of just fun as a, it's almost like, it's more of a hobby than any sort of, you know, weightlifting for aesthetics than anything else. It's not really a sport per se. I don't know, I just enjoy it. I guess the benefits that I've had as far as changes in my life go have been greater with my, you know, success as a bodybuilder, so to say, than my success as a poker player, I would say. Maybe.
How so?
Well, examples are, I don't want to always go back to, like, you know, girls and picking up girls, but a good example is when I was at school and, like, won a tournament for, like, $500,000, you're in third-year university, you tell a girl that, first of all, they probably won't even believe you. Second of all, you learn very quickly that that really makes very little difference as to whether or not, not that I was going around telling people, but my friends would. And I just kind of learned quickly that, like, being successful isn't about how much money you have. It's about your personality, you know? And when it comes to confidence and your personality and social skills, which really are a lot of skills that help with enjoyment of life, you know, to be able to walk into a place and feel confident, instead of always being insecure and feeling awkward and not knowing what to say and thinking about, oh no, like this person's looking at me or what, like always feeling insecure. When I started getting into bodybuilding and really working on my body and starting to really feel happy about, you know, how I looked and stuff like that, it really just gave me that confidence to walk into a place and feel, you know, just feel successful regardless of my bank account, you know? Yeah, I don't know. It sounds shallow and very like kind of not materialistic, but I guess shallow is the right word. But it was a real big kind of change to my life to kind of, you know, the benefits of looking good or trying to look good, you know? Yeah.
And you mentioned at college, a lot of younger girls typically, they don't really care about money. They care how the guy looks. And then as you get older, they still care how the guy looks, but then they start caring about money. Even if all women, they say they don't care about money or like it's not about money, but it certainly assists you. I think it just adds to everything about you. I mean, if you have money, typically you have success. Typically, you're good at something. Those are all qualities.
It's just status. A lot of it is just status. Like if having money just shows that you have a certain status within society, If a guy is broke, but, you know, just managing to pay the bills, but owns a bunch of restaurants or clubs on a busy street in the city, they're going to do very, very well with women, because when women that are really attractive go into their club, they're the owner, they're the boss, they're the big dog, you know? So a lot of it is just status, a lot, like on a social level. A lot of successful people are successful because they do own a company, or they have a lot of network connections. You know, they have those connects. You know, they know famous people, or they, you know, there's, and that's kind of what's very attractive to girls. I mean, obviously, there's the financial part, is just the security of but in my experience, girls are not looking for rich guys because they want them to buy them a purse. They're looking for rich guys because they want to be seen with a guy that people respect, right? They want to be with a guy that has social respect, you know? And I guess being successful financially is a form of quantifying that social respect. Yeah.
Cyan T asked a great question. Says, what do we do about that confidence if we don't look like LaForte?
Go to the gym. No, that's a good question. I guess working on accepting some of your insecurities. You know, working on certain things, I guess, you know, the certain stumbling blocks in your social life, or in your whatever's holding you back from feeling confident. You have to target what's holding you back from feeling confident to be able to work on it.
I'm gonna go to I'm drinking so much water, I have to go to the bathroom. You continue that point, my friend.
I mean, that was the end of the point. So maybe I'll check in the chat and see what people have to say.
Girls like, what the kind of weird comments are in there? All right, check it out.
Yeah, there are some weird comments in here. Trying to think of what to discuss. One thing I can discuss is how meditation has kind of opened my eyes to things, and how, as somebody who didn't know much, I'm getting into meditation now. It's something I want to talk about today. So he's back. So
go ahead.
Is that cool? Can I foray into talking about that?
I'd love for you to talk about that, buddy. Let's hear it.
Right. So my whole thing with meditation is I really had no idea what to expect. I didn't know much about it. And I think a lot of people are like that. And a lot of people think of it as just sitting there not thinking for 10 minutes, and it seems kind of dumb. And how can it really impact your life? And it seems like a waste of time. And I feel like a lot of poker players think that. I kind of used to think that. And when I started doing it, I also kind of thought that this wasn't really all that drastic, like change how I couldn't see how it was going to change my life. But I had so many people, and so many people I respect, and so many intelligent people that I was coming across and reading their books and reading about different people, really boosting the importance of meditation in their lives, and how everybody, especially in today's day and age and the lifestyles we live, how important it is to develop the skills that meditation helps you develop, right? So I was like, you know what, I'm just going to force myself to do it, regardless of whether I think it's working, whether I think it's whatever. I'm just going to do it for a few months. Like, there's 10 minutes a day, 15 minutes a day, do it. So I did. And it was very... The things that I've noticed are totally not at all what I was expecting. So, first of all, when it comes to actual meditation, a lot of people, including myself, kind of envisioned it as something where you sit there, you close your eyes, and you shut off your brain. You stop thinking. And you just chill. Meditation is not like that at all. In fact, it's very much the opposite. It's very active. I thought of meditation as kind of an inactive process where you're kind of shutting down your systems. But the idea behind meditation is to essentially force yourself into living in the present moment. And so an example of that is a lot of people, they close their eyes within a minute, they're going to start thinking about poker or what they're doing later today or what they're having for dinner or that date that they have tonight. Oh, does that girl, does she like me? She hasn't responded to my message for half an hour. What time do I have to wake up tomorrow? Oh, I got to pay that bill. You know, like, and the thing is there's a chain of thoughts. And what happens is as you get lost in those thoughts, what happens is you start taking for granted what you're experiencing as a human being in the present moment. So you're no longer hearing that bus in the background. You're no longer feeling the sensation of sitting in a seat. You're no longer feeling the sensation of breathing because you're lost in thought. Your experience as a human being is now just your brain and in your mind. And as a very analytical person, I found that before meditation, my experiences were very much of that nature. So I might be walking to the store, but I'm not necessarily in the moment walking to the store because I'm thinking about all these other things. So I'm actually not even really there. I'm just thinking. You know, I could be anywhere. My brain is just my mind is focused on thoughts that are not in the present moment. So the idea behind meditation is that when you do have these thoughts, you develop a skill that lets you see yourself having those thoughts and release them before you get caught up in them. So the idea is that, okay, I still have that thought of, oh, I've got that date later tonight with that girl. She hasn't messaged me back yet, but okay, back to the present moment. You catch yourself, and what happens is you give yourself the ability to focus on where you're at as a human being in the present moment. Focus again on your breath. Focus again on these things. Now, a lot of people are probably asking themselves, okay, that's cool, but who cares? Like, why do you want to focus on the present moment? Like, what does that even benefit you? Well, what I found happening was that the meditation itself is still a struggle. I still have tons of thoughts. I haven't even really gotten that much better at it. I don't feel special afterwards. I don't feel like I've accomplished anything whatsoever. But all of a sudden, I've started having these moments where I will be on that walk to the store. And as much as I meditated 8 hours ago when I first woke up, and I'm not thinking about meditation at all, I still all of a sudden have that moment of realization of releasing that stress of whatever it is I'm thinking about, because it's not relevant right now. Just chill and enjoy the fact that it's a gorgeous day outside, and that tree is a beautiful color, and there's a really beautiful girl walking towards me, and oh, what's that guy doing over there? And, you know, just feeling good about the moment and experiencing life, because I watched a very impactful video. It was like a 5-minute video by Sam Harris on YouTube. Everybody should search for it right now. And it's about living in the present moment. And the whole theme of the video is that no matter what happens in your life, the only thing you ever experience is now. And that was such a profound thing for me to think about, because it's so true. No matter what's happened in your past, no matter what's going to happen in the future, you live life now. And if you're always caught up in thinking about the future and evaluating the past, you're never appreciating and enjoying now. And that's really what I found, what I realized that I was lacking in my life. And I think poker, especially as a poker professional, it's so easy to always be so hyper analytical about the past and about the future that you neglect living in the moment. And that's what meditation has really changed my life in a strange way. It hasn't changed any of the things that I do in my life, but it's changed the way that I do them. And it's been a really, really cool experience. And again, I'm kind of in that experimental stage with it, in that I'm still learning and you know, seeing how things go. But it's been really cool. It's been a positive experience, that's for sure. I really encourage everybody to at least give it a shot. Sorry, I went on a very long rant there again.
It's okay. Someone posted a link. Cyan did a video call. If you're watching this back later, guys, it's called Sam Harris. It is always now.
And yes, you can go. That's cool.
Find that on YouTube. Thank you for linking that up, Cyan. Tender says Lafort, have you read Harris's book, Waking Up?
Yes, I have. Yeah. Very good. Very interesting. I mean, he's one of my favorite individuals. I'd love to. You know, when everybody asks that question of, like, who are the five people you'd like to have dinner with or whatever, he'd definitely be one of them.
Who are the other four?
I knew you were going to ask me that. That's why I almost didn't say that. It's tough to give a good answer without, like, putting some thought into it, right? But definitely. Do they have to be alive?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Because I was going to say Jesus. I think Jesus would have to be number one. I'm not religious, but I think some people think that, like, saying the word Jesus as if he was a person makes you, like, believe. But, like, he definitely existed. He was a dude in history. Like, he may not have walked on water, but he was a dude. I'd love to hear his story. He clearly, I mean, think of the impact he had on the rest of the world for the next 2,000 years. I think it's pretty, suffice to say, he's the most impactful human being that's walked the earth in the last few millennia. So he'd definitely be number one. I've always been a big Tiger Woods fan. And he's had such interesting things go on in his life that I'd love to get, like, his off-the-record opinions on certain things, even some things that pertain to myself and things that I'm still working on and questioning about how I feel about certain things. I'd love to get his insight. There are people.
We'll come back to that one later. I can tell that you're deep in thought, trying to figure it out.
Yeah, it's kind of tough. Like, you put me on the spot with it, right? Because I want to come up with a good answer. I don't want to just, like, name off a few poker players or, like, you know. So okay.
That makes sense. I know. Okay, so before, when last time I had Jay Kuhn on, the last time I had Jay Kuhn on, we and him were talking about, like, a fitness lifestyle sort of retreat thing.
Yeah,
with you and with him and like something we could put on together. And I talked briefly about it with you guys since then. But what do you think about that idea?
I think it's a great idea. I guess my question is what the scope of it would be. Like, I'm not sure, like, what people would want essentially out of something like that. You know, like, is it going to be just limited to fitness? Is it going to involve some poker stuff? Is it going to involve some stuff about girls, about social situations? Like, are we talking?
It's like a fitness and lifestyle retreat. Fitness and so mindset, lifestyle, overall fitness, diet. Pretty much tie everything in together. Not really much poker, but I think this all helps your poker anyway.
Of course. Yeah. So The next question is, like, what types of people are we targeting as the types of people that would like to go? Is it going to be mostly poker players, I assume?
I think it would be people who are, you know, people that watch the podcast or people who are fans of you guys from the poker world that, you know, would want to come to it.
Right. I guess it's difficult for me to envision what it would be like because I don't know what people want, you know. But I love the idea. Like, I think it's really cool. But I just have trouble, like, picturing it because I don't know exactly what people would be looking for, you know? I'm more than open and willing to do it and give it and have fun with it and work with it, but I guess what I wouldn't want to do is, like, waste a ton of time putting something together and then realizing that it's not even what people really wanted. So I think it's one of those things that, like, we need to sit down and get creative with a few beers, like the three of us, and just throw around ideas and brainstorm and then kind of see if we can let it shape on its own, maybe start springing the idea into podcasts and get people's opinions as far as what they would want, what they're looking for, and then we can shape it into something. Does that make sense?
I think it's a good idea. I'll put that, I'll start mentioning that to people actually. Word. Yeah, it's a good idea. I mean, I think it could be like what I was thinking is like it's somewhere like in a beach type of area, like a real nice weather, and we can find some place that I guess whether it's everyone could stay in a similar place. I mean, I'm sure there's some sort of like camping type area where people stay in like a campground sort of thing, and it's I mean I don't know, those are the things I had in my mind that have a gym and it's like a peaceful sort of place and you could hang out for like a weekend or 3 days or something like that.
Yeah, I like that a lot.
Yeah, we'll talk more about it when we're in in Vegas.
We're definitely going to meditate while we're there.
Okay, so meditation.
I froze
a bit. How can somebody get into meditation right now if they want to get into it?
Headspace.com.
Which they have an app too. If you guys haven't heard of Headspace, there's an app and there's a website that you can. Pretty simple. It's pretty simple to get started.
It really, it was really great for me because it dumbed things down to a cartoony level, literally, where they actually have a few little videos of cartoons to explain some of the concepts that I actually tried to explain 10 minutes ago, and it really kind of worked for me, and it's a great way to have a routine of doing it because it's just you do it every day, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, however long, and it just gets you into the routine of doing it.
Okay. We're doing some new rapid fire questions I have. Who is your favorite player in poker?
In what context?
Whatever context you'd like it to be.
My favorite player in poker?
Who's your biggest fan of? Who would you say that if you were like I'm a fan of that person, who would be that person in poker that you're the biggest fan of?
I guess I would say, I feel like it would have to be a tournament player just because they have such personalities. I mean, it's tough not to say Phil Ivey. He's just been around for so long and I had so much respect for him for so long. And I think for the most part, although the last few years maybe indicate otherwise, but I think for the most part he's done a really good job of recognizing when to get out of certain games and when to get into other ones. And I really respect that because I think a lot of people lacked that skill and that caught up with them. Plus, I think the name No Home Jerome is awesome.
His old Borgata name, I believe he used.
Yeah. I can just imagine the first day he was in there after being named Jerome for a few years and being like, oh, by the way, guys, my name's Phil. I'm now legal age to gamble and take all of your money, so by the way, my name's Phil. I should have a better answer for that because, you know, it should have been somebody who was like one of the original WPT final table types of people because I used to watch those all the time with my friends, and we'd always make references to like certain people, like even like Devilfish, you know, rest in peace, like that type of person is probably the types of people that I should be thinking about here. like Mattisau, those types of guys, because they were what, you know, helped blow up poker, really.
Mm-hmm.
Those types of personalities.
I got to remind people, during WSOP, I'm having Jamie Gold. We're doing a podcast together live, so that'll be taking place.
How did you contact him?
Okay, I mean, yeah, I don't know.
Joey Connects, we call him. Joey Connects.
This has been in the plans for months, though, too, so.
What does he do now? Does he play poker?
That's what we got to find out. That's what I want to have on a podcast for.
That's exciting.
I'm pumped up. Luke Armstrong says, would you pay Ben 86 $20,000 for coaching?
No. 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 I don't think there's a whole lot he could tell me that not that I don't already know, but that I don't already have the capability of figuring out on my own. Because we think about poker the same way. And it's really a numbers game. It's not where he would be worth $20,000 an hour would be the type of player that thinks about things exploitatively based. Like, I would think that somebody like Phil Ivey, for example, would be a perfect example of somebody who's really fucking good at poker, but would benefit a ton from talking to Ben 86 about poker, you know? Mm-hmm. Or even some guys like Phil, for example. Like, I'm sure Phil learned a ton from being friends with Ben. It may not have changed how he played, but it probably changed how he thought about certain things, I would guess. I would guess that Phil took more away from Ben than Ben took away from Phil. And that has nothing to do on their successes as a poker player, their intelligence, but purely just the way they think about the game and whose framework you can learn more from.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Who have you learned the most from in poker?
Definitely MDMA. Do you recognize that name at all?
MDMA.
Ooh. Okay, so he was a legend
Is it a poker player or is it a drug?
Nope, both, I guess. But he was, I don't know, I haven't heard from him or about him for probably 5 years, so I assume that he left poker. Basically, he was a legend in the 2+2 forums, and basically the best players at the time, guys like Tom and Brian and Cole and guys like that, would talk about poker hands when they were actually legitimately, genuinely discussing hands. And MDMA would chime in and be like, no, you're all idiots and you're all so wrong. And he had this reputation for being this like troll. But whenever he did release tidbits of information, it was groundbreaking, profound game theory stuff. And the thing is that nobody knew any of his names because he either didn't play, which is crazy, or he did play, but it was under very secretive names. So what he did was he coached a lot of the best players now, like guys like Ike.
Who is I? I'm sorry, you keep saying Ike, and like I think it's the same person I'm talking about, but I don't know.
Hollywood Paxton.
Oh,
guys like Hollywood.
You keep saying that. I just like it takes me like 10 seconds to figure out you're talking about Hollywood Paxton. Okay, so he coached Hollywood.
Yeah, so guys like that had MDMA coaching, and basically what he did was he completely changed the way I thought about the game. He introduced game theory to me, essentially. And that was by far the most, you know, groundbreaking poker experience, like thing that had happened to me for my evolution as a poker player. So one of his best friends was Kotkis. Do you know the name Kotkis? Wow. Oh, you lagged out a bit.
I don't know who that is.
This is another 2+2 legend. He had a graph from Party Poker 510 when the games were getting tough, and he had over 100,000 hands at a win rate of like over 20 BBs, when like at a time when nobody was beating the game for more than like 6 or 7 BBs, but he was doing all the shit that everybody does now way before they were doing it. And the thing is that he always self-admittedly lacked any dedication or motivation towards playing poker. And he never really cared much about... I also don't know if he had the skills to, you know, emotionally withstand high-stakes matches. Like, there's a lot more going on than just the raw ability to understand a strategy as far as being successful as a poker player, right? But as far as just raw game theory fundamentals and poker understanding, he was way better than anybody that in the world. Like, looking back at it now, it's easy for me to see that. But he never really blossomed into, like, I think he left, or he might even just play mid-stakes now, for all I know. Like, I think he just chilled in Thailand, was that type of guy. But just super genius. Like, anyways, I'm not sure, like, I don't know who's watching as far as the viewers go, but anybody that's been around 2 plus 2 for a while should be familiar with those two names. So, yeah, so I got MDMA coaching in, like, 2008, 2009. And the other interesting thing about that was that when I had that coaching, I actually wasn't playing poker, because it was during a time where I was flipping a house and doing a real estate project that lasted like almost 9 months. So I basically had 9 months where I was learning a new way to think about poker without playing any poker. So I was just being hyper analytical to the point where I was taking hours breaking down like one turn situation. And that really benefited me in a lot of ways. It just completely changed how I thought about poker strategy. So I'd say that was, what was the original question? It was like,
who have you learned the most from in poker?
Yeah, definitely MDMA, for sure.
Who do you look up to in poker or admire?
I think that's changed over the last year because of all of the things that we talked about for the first hour. My admiration for people in poker is no longer necessarily just limited to their poker success and or their poker knowledge and understanding of the game. It's also encompassing how well they are at balancing a complete lifestyle while also maintaining those other things. So I think a very good idol for that concept or that theme would be somebody like Cole, for example, who, you know, just recently got married, clearly goes on these awesome expeditions and does fun stuff and snowboarding, and clearly lives a pretty cool life. He's a healthy guy, but, you know, he still has the ability to just hop in the 25-50 Zoom pool and do really well. So I think that's really, really impressive. Not to take away from anything away from somebody like Ben, either of the Bens, really, Ben86 or Sauce, and not even to say that they're not living a complete lifestyle, but it's impressive that, like, Cole seems to also be doing a lot of other stuff and isn't necessarily as hyper-focused on poker as some of the other guys are that he's playing against. Trying to think of some other people. I mean, I've also really changed how I think about people like Daniel Negreanu, for example. I used to resent the fact that he would make so much money when, you know, I felt as though I'd be super happy to play against him heads up. You know, like why is he the one making all this money? And it's like, when you come from the online poker background, as a kid, not understanding a lot of life skills yet and not really understanding the power of marketability and the power of networking and knowing the right people and making business decisions and publicity and taking the most of different opportunities, when you're just looking at things from a poker standpoint, it's frustrating that the guy making the most money is not the best poker player. Okay? It's frustrating that he would say something like, oh, I think I can beat 25-50 online by only having a week to study or a month or whatever it was. But when you realize that him saying that is what makes him that personality that's getting that number one poker stars endorsement and sponsorship and is getting all of those other extracurricular opportunities, you have to respect what he's done as a person. For those other life skills, you know, he deserves how rich he is, not necessarily purely because of his, but obviously he's a very good poker player. I'm not taking anything away from his poker skills. What I'm saying is that I have more respect for him now for his complete skill set as a successful human being. And there's no longer really any resentment towards him for having, you know, all the money type thing. So there are definitely some, I mean, I think some people like that, like Phil Hellmuth and people like that, are other decent examples of those types of people that I used to maybe, it's almost like, there used to be frustrating because it's like there's like arm wrestling competitions and this one guy's crushing the entire world and it's like, I know I could beat him, but they just won't let me in the tournament. You know, just let me at him. I'm going to beat him. I know I can beat him in an arm wrestle. But they, like the world won't let me play him, you know? And it's like that's the feeling you have as like a good poker player, seeing somebody that you know you would beat, but they're making millions more money than you. It's really, really frustrating. And then I got older and realized that the reasons why they were in the positions they were in were for skill sets that I was not appreciating and recognizing enough. Does that make sense?
Definitely makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
Whoa. Feedback.
You would
hear that? No. Okay. So has that changed your outlook on how you look at poker for your own self then? Is that something you've thought about how you could do more of yourself?
Yes, but not so much within the environment of poker. Because I've kind of utilized those ideas into other avenues, like investing and things like that. I'm doing my best now to get on. I mean, the reason I am posting things like shirtless selfies on Instagram is because I'm actually starting to recognize the fact that the generation just before mine, like I'm 30 years old, but when I meet people who are 25 years old, like Instagram is their everything, you know? And that's something that I didn't understand before, but there's so much value in social media that gaining a following may not seem to have immediate value, but in 5 years from now, when I'm not playing poker and I'm doing something else, being somebody who's known is going to be super beneficial in that very random instances can occur, especially when you have capital to invest in certain ideas. The world is very entrepreneurial now. I mean, the people making money, the most amount of money now, are not the boring iBankers and people like that. It's the people who make the next Facebook or the next Instagram or the next Uber. The world's incredibly entrepreneurial, and networking is very important. And if you can become socially present and also be known as a guy that has money to invest, I mean, I'm actually involved in a couple different startups, and the reason why I've invested in one of them is because of a group of friends that I had through poker and being social and being socially active with them. And when they had a friend that came up with a great idea, and they thought of people they knew that had money and wanted to invest, I was near the top of their list, right? So I'm also working on that now with my portfolio. So I'm coming up on the first year of managing my own stock market portfolio, basically managing probably about half my assets in the stock market. And that's gone really, really well. But instead of being very hyper secretive about it, I've tried to involve the select group of people that I see as very intelligent people as a means of starting to develop a bit of a following, because if it does grow into something big, I don't want to just all of a sudden be this guy coming out of the blue saying, hey, I have this cool strategy, everybody check it out. I want to be at a point where I've already got a following of people that understand my strategy and friends that have been involved and people that are helping, people that, you know, I just developing a framework as opposed to the idea of just being an isolated, solitary online poker player that just lives in my computer and doesn't use and other people and help other people to kind of evolve into other things. So I guess it's more of like a macrocosmic business outlook an attitude towards things as opposed to strictly just being a poker player. That's kind of what I'm always trying to work on, I would say.
No, I think the first time we had you on the podcast, RIP that podcast, I don't know. I think I have it on the computer. I got to put it on iTunes. I remember you were talking about just getting into investing, and now it's funny to look at it 1 year later, and now you're 1 year into it. How has it been going? What have you learned? What could you tell us out there who are potentially us newbie investors?
Well, I've definitely learned a lot. It's kind of difficult. We'd need to almost do another whole podcast for me to sum up those things. I've done really well with it. I mean, it's tough to know how 1 year, like how big of a sample size 1 year is for what I'm doing. But in my first year, I think I have another 4 weeks left or something like that. I'm going to be somewhere in the range of making 25% to 30% on my portfolio versus the market, which is going to be around 8%. So I've absolutely crushed it. I probably ran pretty good, but I feel really good about my strategy and some of the reasons why it's good. I'm firming up my justifications for why I'm beating the market instead of just hoping and having dumb luck and just hoping that my strategy is working. It's kind of the difference between, like, you know, just check raising guys here because they fold a lot and it's just working, or actually doing the math and realizing that this is precisely why check raising here works, you know? So I'm kind of firming up precisely why my strategy is doing well as opposed to just kind of implementing it and hoping it does well, you know? There's a big difference between being able to do something that works and actually explaining why it works, you know?
Gotta write that down, Sean. Look at this, man. There's so much strategy in this. This is why the first one got taken off YouTube, man. The two after that were less strategic because there's so much strategy. There's just so much. So can you repeat that? Can you repeat that thought back to me one more time, my friend? I'm gonna jot this down on my note list I have for the podcast.
I don't remember what I said. I said there's a big difference between implementing something that works.
But knowing why, knowing why it works.
Understanding why it works.
Yeah.
I mean, it's kind of like that old adage that you don't fully understand something until you're able to have the ability to teach it to other people, right? I think people that are bad teachers in poker. That's a reflection of their lack of understanding sometimes about what they're doing or why it's working. Not always. I mean, there's other reasons to be a bad teacher. But I think having the ability to break things down and fully understanding them inside and out is going to be kind of the highest level of understanding of something, you know? So that's what I've aimed for. What I've aimed for with my investing adventure and journey.
You know, it's a really interesting point you just made because, you know, thinking about it from my own perspective, if I was going to help somebody get better at poker, like, I don't necessarily know if I'd make the best teacher, although I've never taught anybody, I've never coached anybody, I'm not coaching anybody. But when it comes to something like basketball, for instance, where when I started learning basketball, you know, about a year and a half, or maybe like a year and 6-7 months ago now, I'm playing. When I learned basketball, I learned the fundamentals. Like, I just studied the fundamentals. I worked on the fundamentals. Now, when I'm talking with somebody at basketball and I'm talking with someone who's trying to get better, they're worse than me, I can explain exactly what I can break it down and tell you things, why I'm doing something in basketball or why I try to do something that the person's like, holy shit, I've never thought about that in my life. Mm-hmm. Whereas I guess when it comes to poker, I probably wouldn't be the same way just because maybe my fundamentals when I first started or even now are not necessarily that strong. And I get, yeah, it's really interesting, interesting way to put it. Why some people, it's a good way to look at it. Interesting way to look at it.
Yeah, for sure. Definitely. I learned that going to school as an engineer. Whenever we were doing physics problems, or really any types of problems, like if you were stuck on solving the problem, the best thing to do was to always rely on first principles. So, because first principles can always, those are the original building blocks. So in theory, you can get to any solution by understanding the first principles, right? So it's kind of like in poker. If you really understand the fundamentals and the opening principles of things, you know, the pot odds, the simple things like that, then you should be able to break down problems, you know? You have the capability of doing so. Yeah. But anyway, investing stuff has gone really well, so I'm excited about that. And I'm hoping, fingers crossed, that it's not just dumb luck. The question, obviously, I don't expect to crush the market by 20% every year, but even to crush it by 5 or 10% would be super awesome. I mean, that's a huge thing, like a really big deal. So something that I could maybe turn into something. We'll see.
Razvan says, is it mutual funds or individual stocks?
Individual stocks. I mentioned it last time, but the book, the original book that I read where I formulated my strategy was called Quantitative Value by Wes Gray and Tobias Carlyle. And they've actually since started their own fund. And you can find it online somewhere. I think it's like Alpha Architecture, or there's a few different websites they're involved in. And it's like a, I think they have $40 million. So it's actually a pretty smallish fund. But they're employing the same strategy, although extremely limited and conservative. I'm a lot more hyper aggro with it, which you can be when you have less capital to invest, and you're also investing your own money as opposed to other people's money. So, are you scratching your back?
I'm massaging myself. I learned this from an Asian woman in an airport when I was getting a massage in a spa. You put your spot against a hard spot and you can massage it. So I have a knot here always in my back from basketball. So I'm just massaging it basically.
Yeah. That's cool.
Brendan says, when can we invest? Shout out to Brendan, by the way. When can we invest in the Fort hedge fund? I'm in. Sign me up, motherfucker.
Hopefully that's where I'll be in 5 years from now. I mean, I've actually thought about that before. Is like if I actually did, and I'm trying not to like count any chickens before they hatch. I'm not saying that this is even really a plausible scenario, but if I actually did manage to unlock a really, really good strategy, would I really want to take on the massive project of turning it into investing other people's money and not just my own? And I'm not sure if I'd really be willing to, because if I was that successful with it, then I'd be at a spot with my own financial freedom that I wouldn't need to do something like that. So it would be purely a gain, a fun thing. It's like you're already super rich and it's just a matter of getting like even more unnecessarily rich, you know? So
is this like some deep GTO you've been doing with the podcast now? So you're like, you're gonna come on the podcast for the next 5 years and then eventually everyone's gonna love you so much that you're gonna be like, I'm taking on investors in my hedge fund, and then all of a sudden everyone from the podcast put their money into it.
Hey, it's a perfect example of what we were just talking about, right? By opening myself up to social media, if I do decide to do that one day, I am going to have a bunch of people who are at least familiar with the idea and may be looking to actually invest. So, you know, it's a good example of kind of tying some of the things you do in together and using social media along the way, you know?
Mm-hmm. I'm in. I'm still in. I don't care, man. Book Max, Reserve Max, whatever it is. I'm putting the role in there. I'm gonna try. And by 5 years, everyone watching the podcast now, everyone's gonna have a lot of success from a financial standpoint because they've got the podcast run good and the positivity of the podcast on their fucking side, and they're gonna be crushing it, man.
That's true.
I can't wait, man. I get a lot of messages all the time from people. What's up?
We'll all get rich together.
I mean, I get a lot of messages from people still that are always very very positive in nature, and they say it's helped them a lot. I get some messages from people who are tell me about their journeys and listening to the podcast and how much success they're having at poker now, which I don't know how I feel about that, but you know, shout out to you guys. I'm glad you're doing well, my friend. Shout out to you guys.
What else do we got? Any more questions to talk about? I feel like I've talked a lot and like rambled a lot in this one. I'm not sure.
We're here for you, man. We're not here. I did 4 podcasts this week. I'm here. We're here for you, kid.
All right. I like the other ones. We kind of had more fun banter and stuff and random topics that we talked about. But this one, I kind of went on some rants about things that hopefully people enjoyed, but hopefully it wasn't a letdown.
No, I think they'll love it. How question for you is, if you were going to approach a World Series of Poker full schedule or a big schedule, how would you approach it from a health perspective? assuming you're one of the guys there. Maybe not you specifically, but what recommendations would you give to other people out there that are going through this right now?
I've done that before. Let's start off by saying that. First thing I do when I get to Vegas is I go to Whole Foods. Second thing I do is I go to a supplement store. Third thing I do is get a gym membership. And that's my – I mean, the great thing about tournaments starting at noon is there's no excuse for you not to be able to be active in the morning. I mean, what are you doing between the hours of 9 and noon? So there's really no excuse not to go be active if you want to be. Definitely prepare, meals and snacks. I mean, most people are smart enough now that they bring a backpack or a bag or whatever to the Rio, get used to munching on nuts or whatever so that you don't have to go buy a chocolate bar or whatever other, bad food item that you might be forced into buying. The other thing, too, is the more you make health a bit of a priority, the less you need to rely on unhealthy things. So if you are going to the gym in the morning, you're probably going to feel really good at 10 p.m., 11 p.m. Like, I remember, it's funny you say this because this actually happened to me when I went really deep in, when I finished third in 2011, I think it was, in the 5K. I'll never forget, the second day of the tournament, we were playing until like 3 or 4 in the morning, and everybody, we were down to the final table, and everybody was bitching about the fact that we were still playing. Everybody was so tired and felt like shit. And I was the one guy hoping to God that they were just going to continue playing throughout the night because I felt fantastic. I've been going to the gym every day, getting good sleep, eating healthy. Everybody else was run down, had like the real fever, real blues, real cold. I was feeling great. And I think it probably benefited me a bit in those last 6 hours of that day where I was still very, really sharp. So I mean, it can pay off to be healthy for like more than just an enjoyment standpoint. It can also be financially good too. I mean, it's easy to fall into a habit of being unhealthy and actually start not playing that great because, and I see this a lot. Like, I'm shocked at how many times I've been at the World Series and been playing a tournament, especially in the early stages of a tournament with a good player, like somebody I know who's good at poker, and they just make a terrible play at my table where it's very clear that they just were not paying attention to the fact that that guy was like the nittiest guy at the table, and to just like shove a no equity bluff into him or whatever is just terrible. And it was just a matter of them not paying enough attention. So I think it's easy to get into the habit of going to the Rio every day. First few weeks don't go that great. You're not really that healthy. You're living a bit of a gen lifestyle. But because you're a good poker player, you can go to the Rio tomorrow and it's fine, and hopefully you do well in the tournament. And you're taking for granted that you're playing well. But really, you might actually not be playing that great and not even realize it because you're just not really sharp, So those would be my tips. I think there's a lot of value both from a enjoyment standpoint but also from a financial standpoint to make sure that you're making the effort to be healthy. And the thing is that there's a good chance if you're living in a house with four or five other people at the Rio, or sorry, not at the Rio, but in Vegas, friends and stuff, that they're not going to be living healthy. So you actually have to make a conscious effort to be the one that's actually making, you're going to have to go to the gym alone sometimes. You're going to have to eat a meal alone sometimes. It's just the way it's going to be if you want to be healthy oftentimes. Although I will say, the last couple of years that I've gone, I've been really impressed with some of my friends and the lifestyles that they've been living compared to years prior. I mean, last year I hung out with all the guys like Donnie, and he lived in a house with Brian Hastings, but Brian Flaws Victory, and I don't think Emil was there, but like Scott Seaver and ZJ and guys like that. And they were doing like, they had like these CrossFit workouts in the morning where they were doing stuff in the backyard, which was awesome. And they had like all sorts of supplies of like food and nuts and fruits and vegetables and stuff. And it was really cool. And they were doing a lot of cooking and stuff. So that was really awesome. So I will say that I think a lot of poker players have done a better job over the years of learning how to be healthy at the series.
I think that's kind of in line with the general population of North America. I think everyone's kind of been more health conscious and workout conscious and all those type of things. So I think it's kind of coming over into poker world too.
Yeah, and I mean, we're all getting older in the poker world, right? Like for the most part, the same people that have been around, and we're all 10 years older than we were 10 years ago. So when you're in your late 20s or, you know, hitting 30 and stuff, life's different than when you're 22. So
yeah, you mentioned when you went late in that tournament that you thought you had an advantage over everyone else who was wore down. There's actually there's an Ironman tournament. I think they have something. I think it's in some sort of, I think it's in somewhere in Asia, maybe APPT, and the tournament, like, it, you don't, there's no breaks, and it's super deep, and it sometimes lasts for days. So I was actually thinking about going to play that because, I mean, I know those, no shots at, I mean, this is racist. I know those Asians are very degenerate when it comes to long sessions, but, you know, I feel like this tournament was made for me, and maybe, but I don't know. I never lived healthy before, and I could play for days. Maybe if I'm healthier now, it's a bad thing.
I feel like that tournament might involve some extracurricular drugs. It's got to be a benefit to take some certain types of drugs for a tournament like that, I would think. No? Maybe? No?
I don't know. I mean, I'd be intending to, yeah, potentially
indulge?
Bring up a certain prescription I may or may not have to the country, of course. I feel like that would give me an edge, but I'm gonna win that tournament, and over the next 5 years, I'm gonna play that tournament and I'm gonna try to win it.
I like that. I want to buy some of your action.
Well, I mean, it is. I think I'm pretty sure it's also No Limit, so I haven't played No Limit in a long time. So
that's fine. We'll figure it out.
How hard can it be, right? It's an endurance match, right?
There's only two cards.
That's true. In theory, that's true. Okay, guys, from the guys in the chat, we're gonna take a couple questions from you guys. Can we get the tattoo story?
Oh God. The story goes.
So for those listening on iTunes, like 10 months from now, you have a picture of a. Let me see the tattoo. Hold on. All right. Okay. Ace, King, diamonds.
Notice the suit.
Okay.
All diamonds. It's a maple leaf, Canadian leaf.
Okay. Why do you have this big tattoo in your arm of Ace, King? I never saw this either. So this is new to me.
All right. So basically, when I was 19 years old, 18 years old, poker just started blowing up. I was religiously watching it every Sunday, 2 p.m., City TV, WPT, Final Table. Loving watching it. Hadn't played online yet. Playing $5 sim goes with my friends. Really, really, really enjoying it. Like that first, when you first get into poker. And then I had a friend at work. I worked at this factory, and he had this other friend who was like, you know, award-winning tattoo artist, and they were into getting tats, and I was like getting into being friends with these guys, and I was like, yeah, I kind of want one. And then he asked his friend, and his friend's like booked for 6 months, but he's like, but I can get you in like next week or something. Like it was a one-time shot. I had to figure out what I wanted within the next week. And I was like, yeah, you know, I'm going to do it. And then I was like, what in my life do I enjoy that I feel as though I'll still enjoy when I'm old, you know? Because the thing is like, if I got like a hockey tattoo, yeah, I was into playing hockey, but like I knew within 5 or 10 years I wasn't really going to be playing high-level hockey anymore, you know? And I had all this like energy and compassion towards poker, and I also thought that poker cards themselves are kind of artistic, and little do, like, a lot of people don't realize, like, in a deck of cards, every jack, queen, and king is actually a historical figure, and there's a story behind the development of the deck of cards, and there's actually some symbolism and things like that. So I tried to work with that and thought it was cool. And Big Slick, Ace King suited, was like, you know, hand in poker. And I was like, well, if I get it suited to the Maple Leaf, then that shows some like pride. And at this point, you have to understand, I'm not a poker player. Like, I probably played lifetime like 243 hands of poker in my lifetime at this point. And then I was like, you know, getting a foreign language symbol is like cool. So the king is actually the king of spades, and the king of spades is actually King David from David and Goliath. So it's kind of like the little guy. And at that point in high school, I was little, believe it or not. I just kind of hit my growth spurt later, and I obviously didn't get into bodybuilding and working out until I was older too. So that was kind of symbolic. And then the symbol, as far as Chinese symbols go, they're very limited to single characters. Like, a lot of Chinese words or sayings are actually two characters, and I didn't really have room for two characters. But one of the ones that was one character was a symbol for good fortune, or good luck in wealth or fortune, or like good luck in success with wealth type of thing. So I got that, and that's basically the story. So I brought it in. I thought it was going to be the size of a card, and it would be hidden under my sleeve, because the idea was that if I get into some sort of industry where I don't want to show that I have a tattoo, I can still be fine wearing a t-shirt. But what happened was, in order for him to do the details, it had to be kind of big, and I just said, fuck it, and I got it. And the artwork in it is kind of cool. Like, I've never really regretted it or anything. It's just something I did when I was young. And obviously, as my arms grew twice the size, so did the tattoo. So it's actually a lot bigger than it used to be. But yeah, I mean, it's one of those things that a lot of poker players laugh at, you know, like kind of roll their eyes like, oh, poker tattoo. But for the most part, other people have always thought it's kind of cool. Like, it's whatever, you know, it's a tattoo. And tattoos are actually really big right now in Toronto. Like, you're not cool unless you have sleeves, basically, in Toronto right now. I don't know if it's like that elsewhere.
Do you tell this whole entire story to women when they say, why do you have Ace King on your arm? What's like the, what's your go-to version you tell people that's not, that wouldn't be that?
It would be the summed up version of that. And then I'd quickly foray into something more interesting to talk about.
GTO right there. GTO Lafort. That was some very brief women GTO you gave us.
Yep. You gotta take advantage of those transitions, you know?
Hashtag angry GTO. Would you get something like Ace King, Ace King on your arm, or what would you do now in retrospect?
I should add two more cards. I never thought about that before. Yeah. I'm not sure what I'd probably put, like, you know, like 7-4 or something. You know, like a 30th percent on hand or something, just for fun.
Billy says, what does Lafort think of a ketogenic diet? Which is, I can't remember the exact specifics of that, but
yeah. Essentially, ketogenic is, and I'm not a nutrition expert, but my knowledge of it is basically eliminating most carbs and generating your body's energy instead of from carbs, mostly from fats and proteins. I think it's basically the way we're supposed to eat, the way our bodies are designed to eat, and I think we function extremely well on that diet. But the problem is that society itself is not designed with a framework to enable somebody to eat that type of diet. If you are going to eat that diet, you essentially are preparing all of your own foods. You're rarely eating at any sorts of restaurants, never eating fast food, never really enjoying some of the things that some people really, really enjoy. And the problem is that as soon as you fall off the wagon, it, as far as my understanding goes, of being ketogenic, where your body's using fats and proteins for energy, and then you have a week where you binge on carbs, it actually takes your body a long period of time to get back into that ketogenesis. So, you know, it's one of those things that, like, if you're really anal about your diet and your health, then yeah, maybe give it a shot and see if you can do it. And you might feel as though your life is better for it. But personally speaking, You know, I went on a date last night or the other night, and we went to an Italian place, and, like, there's no chance I'm having a ketogenic diet in an Italian restaurant. And I also kind of like some foods that I wouldn't want to eliminate from my diet. So I tend not to be too extreme with certain things like that. But the one thing I will take away from ketogenic diets are you'll see that the types of foods that they encourage are, like I talked about earlier in the podcast, are the natural foods, the foods that have not had a lot happen to them before, between them existing as whatever they are and then you putting it in your mouth, whether it be meat, vegetables, fruits, and legumes and nuts and whole grains, like proper grains. Sorry, every time you ask me a question, I just go off for like 5 minutes.
I want to see what a date's like with the fort from like a woman's perspective. I just want to see like.
You'll be swept off your feet, Joey. You will be swept off your feet.
How many dates do you feel like you go on a week? Like 15? I know you're not. I know we don't talk about it. It's the black market list. Whatever the topics of black market, it's fine. But like 15, like 20, like this is like your date every week now.
No, I don't go on that many dates. I'm picky. I'm picky and I'm patient. I don't want to be in a relationship with somebody unless I think it's something that's super, super special. You know, I meet a lot of special people, and we maintain special friendships and relationships, but I'm not looking for...
Special, huh?
My wife, I don't know.
You maintain special relationships with them, huh?
I don't know. But what I'm saying is that I'm not the type of person that needs to be in a relationship. I think being an only child, being independent, I enjoy my life as a single person, and in order for me to want to jump into a relationship, it has to be something very special. I'm totally open to it. In fact, I'd love to be in a relationship. There's a lot of things about a relationship that I really miss, and I think a lot of people don't understand that about me. They think that even some of my friends... they know that I'm not. They know that I treat women very well, but they still maybe associate the idea of me being a player type thing. And that's totally not true. Every time I go on a date with somebody, it's because, like somebody new, it's because I'm, you know, hoping that they're going to be my future wife and we're going to live happily ever after. But I'm also realistic in understanding that that's usually not the case, and I'm not going to waste somebody else's time or waste my own time if I feel like it's not the one. You know, so.
Hmm.
That answer your question?
Interesting. Well, I mean, I got follow-ups to that question for sure, but especially...
If you want, you can ask questions, and I can just have the ability to move on, pass.
In theory, if you live that sort of way, though, right? You want super special. In a way, you could always be chasing that then. You could always be, there's always going to be something you're probably going to want from a prospective partner that you meet. And knowing that you can meet other equally as special people, I feel like you'd be quick to maybe put that person aside and be like, all right, next, it's not super special. I want super special. When super special may never come along.
Right. Yeah, you're totally right. And I've had that thought before, and something I think about frequently. And the whole idea of the first hour of the podcast, when I talked about being happy with what you have and not being so obsessed about finding that next level or that perfect thing, I think is very relevant in this conversation as well. And it's something that I think a lot about. And I do wonder if sometimes it's not the special person that I need to meet, it's the special place in my life I need to be for me to meet the right person. You know what I mean? So it's not even about them. It's about me. And that's entirely possible. I'm really not sure. I mean, it's until then, I'm going to keep dating and formulating my ideas about things. So.
When you figure out the answer to that question, let me know, because I do that all the time too. So please give me...
I thoroughly enjoy dating. Like, I enjoy meeting somebody new and just kind of I also find it fun to talk about, like, I find it really fun to meet somebody new and find out stuff about them. I also find it really fun to talk about yourself and get responses from other people, because they might ask you questions that you don't know the answer to, and it makes you think about it. Like, oh, you're a poker player, you're doing this, where are you going to be in 5 years? It's like, oh, I haven't really thought about that. Like, I've thought about that, but I'm just saying those types of questions where they help you develop. Sometimes when you have other people gaining insight into your life and asking questions and just making connections with people, it helps you develop more insight and be more self-reflective and learn about yourself. And I find that I get that a lot on dating. And it's fun. Like, there's nothing better than taking out a really attractive girl to a restaurant and being that boss and being that couple that other people are looking at and getting attention from the waitress, and they're, you know, like, just, it's fun. I enjoy dating.
I see why LaForte's single now. Never mind, man. Hey, LaForte, you know, we're living, brother, vicariously. Everyone's living vicariously through you, my friend.
Okay.
We're living vicariously through you. Well, I mean, I guess some people, never mind. I'm not even going to get into this anymore, man.
Any more questions?
Ad Victoria says, every girl has four cards. You need to see the flop to see if it has potential. And you have to get to the river to see if it can become the nuts.
That's an interesting way to. I mean, some girls are just drawing dead. Like, come on.
But, PLO, all hands have equity in dating. No girl, some girls have no equity.
No, he makes a valid point. It's just that I have a habit of when I'm drawing slim, that I don't want to waste time waiting around for the river, and I want to see another flop.
So you're kind of playing Zoom with dating, technically.
Yeah.
So LaForte lives his life like a goddamn Zoom pool. You're not playing heads up, you're playing fucking Zoom.
Yeah, it's fun. I'm just clicking buttons out there.
Wow, I gotta tweet that Ad Victoria sentence out, by the way. Every girl is four cards. You need to see if it has potential. And
I didn't know Ad Victoria followed you. I think he plays like mid stakes heads up, I think, for the most part.
Yeah, no, if Ad Victoria followed me, what kind of fucking blasphemous shit is that, LaForte?
Well, dude, I didn't
Ad
know.
Victoria made up the Yarny song. You know the Yarny song? Yarny, Yarny, Yarny. Gotta get the money. Ad Victoria was the one that linked the fucking Yarny song to us, the first place.
I didn't know that.
Ad Victoria is literally one of the biggest legends in live stream podcast history. Yeah. And then he turned into a heads up PLO crusher.
Yeah, I've seen him. I think we played a little bit just here and there or whatever. I don't remember anything about his game. But.
Chris R. says, I feel like LaForte should start a religion. Tim Johannes says, Johansson, LaForte equals life goals, poker goals, body goals, dating life goals, mindset goals. He is perfect. He is God. LaForte, have you ever thought about starting a religion?
No, definitely not.
Okay. Jamal says, nah, lies, this dude is bluffing, wants them to be his wife, quote unquote. Yeah, okay, buddy, you want to take them out to get that. Okay, there you go.
No, I mean, do I want to talk about this or not?
No, you don't. Okay, let's move on. No, not going to be able to talk about it, probably. Okay, go ahead, you want to talk about it?
No, well, no, I guess not. I'm very, very respectful. I'm not looking for anything that nobody. I feel like when guys are single for an extended period of time and then they get a reputation for dating a lot of girls, and, you know, they're dating attractive girls, they have a reputation for being a player. And maybe that's true of a lot of them, but I'm never, ever deceitful. I'm never ingenuine. I'm always honest. I'm always upfront. I'm always. Very open communicatively. Like, I try to make an effort to make things clear. I really get turned off by that mindset of, like, oh, you know, trying to get that pussy or whatever. Like, some guys are, you know, I'm not like that at all. Like, might have been like that for when I was 22, 23 years old and young and dumb and not knowing much about the world, but at this point it's, you know, it's about kind of making connections with people, and if it evolves into something where we enjoy that aspect of life together too, that's fine, but it's not, certainly not my goal when I'm going on a date, that's for sure.
Plus one. I mean, I say that all the time. When I was younger, that wasn't the goal at all. The goal, I mean, that was the only goal. I mean, when I was younger.
I think that's one of the biggest differences between being 30 and being, like, 23 when you're a guy is just, like, your mindset when, like, interacting with the opposite sex. Because when you're that young, you're still just so full of, like, hormones, you know, that you don't really know any better.
Mm.
And, I've definitely evolved a lot in that regard, I think.
Somebody on Twitter said they almost unfollowed me for posting that on Twitter. Oh my gosh, uh-oh. Okay, where's that question? Goatsy Obama says, does LaFord have some tips for Joey and his fitness challenge? So the fitness challenge, I have until August 31st, and me and my friend are doing the challenge, which I told you a little bit about on Twitter. I think you saw on Twitter, but the biggest aesthetic change in our complete body by then to then. Do you have any mm-hmm. tips for me to potentially win this at the end of the time period?
You want to take advantage of illusions, for sure. I mean, like, how are you comparing? Are you comparing with pictures?
Pictures and video, yeah.
Then lighting is everything. You know, like, lighting's going to be huge.
Well, we both took pictures in the same lighting at the same place.
Okay, well, that's what I mean. Like, you need context for me to give you the right answer. Because, to be honest, a lot of the best changes you're going to make are going to be the cheap changes, like lighting or things like that. The week leading up to it, you're going to want to look into how bodybuilders prepare for the stage in their last week and what they do to manipulate their food and water retention. As soon as you dry out your body and get rid of water retention, you're going to look so much better. You want to kind of look full, I assume. You want your muscles to pop, so you want to learn a little bit about carb loading. You want to... I feel like in a time frame like that, it's just like people don't understand. Building muscle is a very long-term journey. So when you're looking at a competition that's a very small scope, like just a few months or whatever, the biggest changes you can make really are burning fat. Like you can really get hyperactive with burning fat in a small period of time. You cannot put on a ton of muscle in a small period of time. So I feel like the benefits in a competition like that would probably be even greater by just getting that look of being ripped and tight, even though you're not any bigger than you were putting on new muscle. So I probably...
That's why I made the bet, LaFort. That's why I made the bet.
Yeah.
That's exactly why I made it. Cause he's a skinny guy. He's got to put stuff on. Whereas that was my plan pretty much most for the entire bet was that was what I'm going to do.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, so, I wish you luck.
Thank you. I'm going to take those tips into mind going into the last week, though. And
yeah, just look it up. Like, Google it. Google, like, you know, bodybuilding competition prep. And there's even tricks like, I mean, if you want to get really crazy, there's tricks where people even do stuff like they'll sleep with, like, Saran wrap and Preparation H on their skin, and it sucks out the water, so that the day, yeah, I'm telling, like, this, these are the things that people do. Look photo ready. And what it does is it just, like, sucks the water out. I'm trying to think of some of the other tricks.
B-Head asked a question, how would someone go about losing belly fat the quickest and healthiest way? Which is...
I mean, the healthiest way, like, the quickest and healthiest way is that's basically a contradiction. The healthiest way to do something is always going to be the long-term sustainability way, right?
I got to go to the bathroom and for all this water you keep making me drink, so keep going. I can hear you.
The quickest way to do something is almost always not the healthiest way to do something. Like, the quickest way to lose belly fat is going to be do a ton of cardio at a massive caloric deficit to the point where you're just, you know, you feel like shit every day because you don't have much energy. But obviously that's not healthy. So you kind of have to make a decision to fall somewhere on the spectrum as far as how quickly you want to lose your belly fat versus how much you want to enjoy life on that journey. So I always kind of advocate a longer term approach to things, because if you do get very hyper active in doing something like, I want to lose a ton of belly fat the next 4 months, it's very easy to fall off that wagon and you end up not doing it at all. But if you give yourself a year and you understand that being at a slight caloric deficit and getting a good amount of exercise is going to see promising gains as the months go by, and you're accepting of that progress, it's a much better journey and you probably are less likely to fall off that wagon. The problem is that everybody wants the quick fix. And the people who only accept the quick fix are the people who don't reach the goals that they want to reach.
Yeah. Voila. Voila.
Voila. Hopefully that answers the question.
I think so. The fort is on level 9 for this stuff. Fuck it. When is the fort starting the call? I want in. Martin says, I would follow a fort anywhere as well. You gotta be starting that call pretty soon, I think.
Yeah, man. No, I enjoy kind of spreading my knowledge about stuff. Not to say that I have a lot of knowledge, but I feel as though when I do talk about stuff, people tend to learn some things, or at least gain a different perspective. And that's something that's always bothered me a lot about poker, is that poker is something that obviously I have a lot to give as far as knowledge, but it's clearly negative EV to give that. So now that I kind of have some insight in other areas of my life, I actually really enjoy talking about them, because it gives me an opportunity to help people that I don't have with poker, you know? So, yeah, it's fulfilling for sure. Again, another one of those things that bring happiness that has absolutely no connection with monetary value or how big your pile of money is, you know? Those are the realizations that I've had in the last 5-10 years of my life, for sure. Those types of things.
That's a big reason why I started doing the podcast.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, man. Chris R. says, LaFort would be an awesome personal trainer.
Absolutely. I'd be kick-ass. I'd be the best. But it's something that I thought about doing when I'm retired, basically. I think it'd be I'd really enjoy it. Like, I'd probably do it for free, and what I'd do is I would want to work with who I thought were the absolute best stories. So, like, I'd make people write, like, a one-page, two-page essay or something as to why they should work with me or something, and then the most inspiring people are the people that I would want to kind of work with, you know? Not necessarily guys that want to get jacked, or women that are super fat and need to lose weight, or guys that are super whatever skinny and want to, like, but just the people themselves that I feel like are, you know, would be the coolest to work with. But the problem with that industry is, like, there's no money in it. Like, you go to a Good Life or a 24-hour fitness, and those trainers are, like, barely getting by with, like, the worst hours. So anybody who's knowledgeable, who's actually knowledgeable about these things, in order to understand, like, the human body is very complex, and exercise, the mechanics of exercise, the mechanics of performance, the science behind aesthetics and making changes in the body, all of these things are crazy complex. And in order to understand some of these things, you need to be pretty smart. And if you're pretty smart, chances are you're also into other things where you're making a lot more money, whether it be finance or being a poker player or being a scientist or an engineer or a lawyer. So the people that actually know their stuff, generally speaking, are not even really all that into the fitness industry. That being said, there's plenty of people in the fitness industry that really know their stuff. But at the grassroots level, at your local gym and stuff like that, most of the trainers, I mean, they took a week-long course to be a trainer, and yeah, they're passionate about it, and yeah, they might know some stuff, but there's no guarantee that they're actually, there's not a lot of incentive for there to be good trainers. Like, it's not, the market is very flat. Like there's not room. And when there are great trainers, they are the ones that are working with athletes and celebrities. They're not open to the public, you know? And yeah, those trainers actually do quite well financially. But as far as like people ask me all the time about getting a personal trainer, it's like if you need a cheerleader or like someone to motivate you and someone to keep you going to the gym, then yeah, by all means, that's what they're good for. But if you're actually looking for somebody with a lot of knowledge, it's tough to find one that's good. Like you need, it might take you a few months to find one. They do exist, but the ones that exist tend to be people that are not there for monetary reasons. So like, for example, I know a guy at the gym that I used to work at, and he's been the trainer. He's probably the only trainer that is still there that's been there for the last 5 years, because there's so much turnover because they all realize that they're not paying the bills. And but he also, like, he does bodybuilding competitions, he does modeling, and he does DJing. So he has this, he's designed this lifestyle with a lot of stuff going on, and he's so passionate about bodybuilding and understanding the body and performance and nutrition that he's actually really good at what he does. But a lot of the other trainers are not always the best. And I'm friends with a lot of trainers too. Like I'm not saying they're going to be helpful for a lot of people, especially if you're a beginner. But once you get to the point where you know a bunch about training, you know a bunch about nutrition, if you're looking for a trainer that's going to be more than just inspiration and motivation and a cheerleader, then you're going to want to do a lot of research to find a really good one. Don't just go to your local 24-hour fitness and say, hey, hook me up with a trainer, because it's probably not going to be worth it.
Okay. Craig says, are we going to see any more videos from the Fort Ennis channel?
I uploaded one yesterday, Craig. now that I have this new webcam, thank you, Joy, by the way, Logitech 920, it's actually very refreshing to be able to do a webcam and not have it crash halfway through and me want to break my computer and put a hole in my wall. So I'm far more open to doing them. And the If It Fits Your Macros one ended up only being like 8 or 9 minutes. So if I can keep them tight like that, I think I should be able to churn a lot more out. The problem is the depth and scope of them obviously are not going to be as deep as some of the other ones, but I think, like we've talked about before, the people just want small snippet videos. They don't want to have a book read to them, so I'm going to make an effort for sure.
It's good. Yeah, well, you have anything else to add, my friend? Been going here for a little bit of time, 2 hours, 2 hours and 30 minutes.
I think we discussed pretty much everything that I had written down. I'll take a quick look at my notes here. I love these books, by the way. They're awesome. Moleskine or whatever.
My notebooks, you write in you.
Yeah, but they're just like, they're so like, they feel so official, you know? Like, I feel like the art of writing things down is just like, you know, disappearing with technology. And I really enjoy writing, like, handwriting, you know? Mm-hmm. It's cool. I don't know. Old fashioned. Yeah, we talked about all that stuff.
I wonder how much people would pay to watch you read a book. Just read the book. Not actually talk about the book. Just read, literally read the book.
I hope not that much. Yeah, I talked about everything that I wanted to talk about. So, if there's any more questions or anything?
Does Chibi Boy says, does he see any downsides of a fitness lifestyle?
Yeah, for sure. There's plenty of downsides. If you really like ice cream and you want to do bodybuilding competitions, you probably won't be able to eat ice cream. It really depends on what level you're talking about. My whole thing is I try to be as anal as possible without letting it infringe on the things that I enjoy in life. So I know that when I go golfing on Sunday, if I don't have 3 or 4 beers on the golf course, I'm going to be in much better shape for workout Monday, and it's going to be better, and it's not going to be setting me back. But I've learned that having those three or four beers with your buddies on the golf course, like, that's – if you're not enjoying those things, then what you're gaining by looking awesome in the mirror because you've got all these gains from working out, it's like it's not even worth it because you're not enjoying the cool parts about life anyways. You know what I mean? So my whole thing is kind of sustainability. Like, I've realized now that, like, I can't really get any bigger and sustain it without having to make a lot more sacrifices. So I'm pretty happy nowadays with my size. That's why I've worked a lot about trying to get leaner and get ripped, especially for the summer. The nice thing, too, is the illusion of getting more ripped makes you look bigger, also, I've learned. So I'm kind of more about sustainability now. So because there are plenty of downfalls in fitness, if you're a girl, I'd say, especially if you're getting into fitness hardcore, there's even more downsides. When you manipulate your metabolism for bodybuilding competitions, as a guy, you have a lot of muscle on your body. And when you're going through periods of starvation and periods of shock and distress to your body gets through those periods of time because it has a lot of muscle mass anyways. It has a lot of mass. As a girl that are doing these bikini competitions, I see so many of them now. And it's like, me and my workout partner, like, we see them every day at the gym. And we'll look at a girl and be like, old competition girl? Yeah, for sure. Definitely old competition girl. What happens to these girls, and I feel bad for them, they manipulate their metabolism so many times from these competitions that they get to a stage where they're no longer able to be lean because their metabolisms are damaged from going through periods of starvation and not having much body mass to go through those periods of time. And, yeah, they look great on stage while they're 23, 24, 25. They're doing these competitions. And then before you know it, they're 28, 29, 20, 30, and you see them at the gym, and it's like amazing form, like great squat, great everything, have a great diet, but they're like puffy, like they can't get lean, and it's because their metabolism no longer has the ability to be lean. So anytime I have female friends that are getting into it, I have this talk with them, and I say, look, I don't want to be the one to tell you not to do them because I'm not, by any means, I don't want to do that, but make sure you understand the implications on how it affects the rest of your life and not just how you're going to look in a year from now on stage, you know? So, so there's definitely a lot of pitfalls of getting a little too carried away, I think, with fitness. I guess that answers the question.
So, guys, if you got a female body, if you happen to be a female bodybuilder out there listening right now, if you have a female friend, you send that.
I mean,
to
it's not, I say female bodybuilders, but even just like I don't know who you like. You just started using Instagram, but like, if you start getting into a habit of like, kind of, you know when you're like on Wikipedia. And you just, before you know it, you're Wikipedia-ing something else, you're checking out this, and before you know it, you know, you just get on this trail. You can do that on Instagram, but before you know it, you're adding all this hot chick and this thing and this other, you know, whatever. And there's you learn that there's this massive fitness culture on Instagram, huge fitness culture. There are people on Instagram who, if you saw on the street, you would never think anything of. There's nothing special about them career-wise or anything. They're not even necessarily a professional bodybuilder, and they have 400,000 Instagram followers. And every time they post a picture, they have thousands of people commenting on it. Like, it's crazy. It's actually crazy. And these accounts are worth money, because now they get paid for promotions. They get paid to be holding a certain protein powder. Like, it's, social media blows my mind. Anyways, so even like all of these girls who are like, they're not even necessarily doing competitions, but they're working out to look amazing right now and like really pressing their bodies in a certain direction. If it's not sustainable, then there are long-term repercussions, right? And there's a difference between a girl that's fit from a wholesome level or a girl that just looks amazing and is doing certain things to look amazing that is going to catch up to her when she's 32 years old, you know? And those are the girls you got to be a little careful with about dating, or at least, you know. But yeah.
Listen, I don't know how many of us watching this are going to have to worry about dating these professional bodybuilding workout girls, competition girls. So, but hey, if some of you guys out there are potentially in the market for those kind of women.
I'm not talking about the bodybuilding chicks, like the huge jacked ones. I'm talking about like the bikini.
That's what I mean. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about too. Yeah.
They're hot.
What? Are they? Are they hot?
What? I'm just saying.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Do they follow you back on Instagram when you follow them?
Mm-hmm. Sometimes. No, usually not, unfortunately. You know what I've learned about Instagram? Instagram is becoming the only place to pick up hot girls. And that's a very bold statement. But it's becoming true. Here's the thing. All these dating sites, there's no... Like, hot girls get so much attention on them, and it's so difficult for them to meet somebody that they really like, that actually they'd rather date them than get all of the attention that they get. And so many girls that I've talked to that are attractive are so, like, actually really love the fact that they no longer have to go to a club to meet guys. Like, I feel like clubbing industry has to be suffering now, like, with all of this online dating and stuff. Anyways, and the thing is when you have a hot girl on Instagram and she gets 20,000, 50,000 followers, like these girls are getting offers from like very successful rich guys to fly them into their city. Like they're meeting people on Instagram, and I know because I have some guy friends that's how they meet their girls. And that's like these girls are living. Man, if you follow, there are people on Instagram that I follow that like, there are girls and they're constantly posting pictures of like traveling the world, and like they don't even have jobs. They're just Instagram famous because they're super hot, and then they meet guys that are like flying them around and stuff. And like, because think about it, if you're a really rich guy, and you're on a dating site, it's so difficult for you to like. The dating sites in Tinder are just, you know, it's for like sevens and eights, you know, the nines and tens are not on Tinder, you know. Anyways, that's what I've learned. So I'm aspiring to meet my future wife on Instagram.
Wait a second, we gotta go back.
I knew this was gonna happen.
Wait a second, we gotta rewind here. Wait a sec. First of all, a new grind has been born, guys. The IGG Instagram girl grind. Finally, yes. I didn't even think we could come up with any new ones, but now we got the IGG. Okay.
IGG.
IGG. Let me get into this. All right. So wait a second. So you're saying that if you, in an online sense, the only way to meet hot girls is on Instagram? Listen, everyone listening right now, no one made it this far that yet's a girl that you know, possibly. And I'm sure maybe one shout to the stalker that's watching this right now, that knows LaForte and is watching this right now. But Instagram, the only way, not in real life, Instagram, that's it?
No. Well, it's incredibly difficult. The difference is that 5 years ago, if you have some very super attractive girl who isn't necessarily in the spotlight, is not a socialite or a celebrity, she doesn't have access to all of the rich, good-looking, successful guys in the world, right? Mm-hmm. You might be able to pick her up. She's not getting a crazy amount of attention. Take that girl, fast forward 5 years, put them on Instagram, and they literally have thousands, tens of thousands of guys buying for them, or they're wanting to date them every single day. Every time they post a picture, they're in the minds of thousands of guys. And some of those guys are actually very successful, have high social status, and now they have a link towards meeting those people. There was not really many avenues for them to meet those people before Instagram. Now there is. Does that make sense?
I mean, listen, I just started using Instagram really like 2 weeks ago or something like that. So this is all, Instagram's this new front to me. I didn't know that this was, I mean, I kind of heard about it before, but I didn't know like this was.
There's a lot of it that goes on. And it's funny, like there's actually a website of I don't know the details because I never checked it out, but I've had people tell me about it. I guess this guy poses as this like fake chic, like rich.
I just saw that. Yes, literally, I was reading that site yesterday. So yeah. I was like, yeah. tagthesponsor.com.
Yes, yeah. And all these girls have been like caught by it because they're hoping it's going to be just like they're, you know, that they've heard about like the actual stories of like guys flying them into their city and they get a cool experience to hang out with a rich guy or whatever. I mean, think about it. Say you're a celebrity. You know, would you rather date like a random girl that just would you rather like spend the night with some like go to the club and like gamble on whether, you know, there's your type of girl there or whatever, or would you rather just like look through a bunch of followers and be like, you know, this is my type of girl, she's crazy hot, she lives in wherever, I'm gonna fly her in, she's gonna hang out with me for the week. You know, like it's the world's changing, I think, as far as that level of like, basically there's social media brings more value to an exposure to girls that are very attractive.
I think a lot of guys don't want to get a girl that from Instagram who is going to meet all these other, like, obviously if she's doing that for you, she's doing that for other guys too. Like I personally wouldn't want to, I don't know, like I don't care how hot she is, I wouldn't want to spend time with someone who's like a professional sex worker basically.
I guess. I mean,
you disagree.
Well, I don't see how it's really any different than a girl you pick up at the bar. It's, you're not the first guy she's ever been picked up by, you know?
I mean, I think it's a lot different. I don't know. Like, if you're paying for a flying and a girl, I mean, you're probably paying her money normally too. This isn't just like you're buying her flight and everything. Yeah. You're typically paying a fee for this.
I'm sure that happens, but I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about, you know, it's not like that. But.
So what, you message them and then you're like, hey, I'll fly you here, we'll hang out.
I'm not saying I've done it. But,
of course, hey, allegedly. Allegedly is what people are doing, allegedly.
Yeah. I know one of my good buddies, he dates a girl that he flew in from London, and she's really cool, has a huge following. She's a DJ model, and that's, now they're a couple.
Yeah. First time people disagree with you. Yeah, before I disagree with you on that one too, about the whole entire meeting a girl at the bar is the same as meeting a girl on Instagram who you then fly to come see. I disagree with that very strongly. I don't think it's the same thing at all.
I don't think it's the same thing either, but I don't think it's, I mean, how do you, like, I don't see how it's any worse than meeting a girl on Tinder. You know, if a girl's willing to go on a date with you on Tinder, willing to sleep with you on the first or second night, then you have to have the same implications that she's done that with other guys, and you have to just get over that. Like, what's, you know.
True.
I mean, that doesn't bother me at all anyways. Like, it's not a, I don't know, as I've gotten older, I think I've kind of separated that type of thing from, like, ego or how I feel about certain things. I don't know.
So you're able to look at it from the perspective that obviously this girl's probably been with other guys. That's fine. I don't care.
Right. Of course. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think I'm the same way about that. You can't really think about that. It's just going to drive you crazy if you're constantly stressing about that or thinking about this girl's done this or done that or done whatever.
Yeah. I mean, I guess what I'm saying is it doesn't even drive me crazy. Like, it doesn't even enter my mind anymore. It's not really something I really put much thought into. I mean, obviously, if a girl is like has worked as a prostitute, then that's going to be part of my formulation of judging what I think about her. I'm not saying it's going to make me think she's a bad person. It's not going to make me think anything, you know, super crazy bad about her. But it's going to change how I feel about her. You know, you know. Whatever.
It sounds like I need to run some Sims here. Give us a tip. Let's say, hypothetically, if someone out there, maybe myself or maybe someone in the chat, was looking at maybe finding one of these hot girls on Instagram and then, you know, potentially getting them to come visit them and wherever they're at, what would be their strategy in like that you've heard your friends do?
I'm still playing small stakes, brother. I don't know. I've never done it. I've never tried to do it. I don't know.
Well, I mean, what you've heard. I mean, allegedly, what you've heard, not what you've done. We know you've not done anything.
The same way as when you have a Tinder match with somebody.
I've never been on Tinder before.
Oh well, you're missing out.
I have too much sexual activity happens when you meet people on those sites, man. I'm out.
Okay. All right. That's fair.
I retired.
You engage in conversation with the person.
How do we get there? We got to get to the conversation first. Let's back up.
Yeah. Direct message.
Can you direct message anyone on Instagram?
Yes.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, don't you just get a lot of spam on there and stuff like that?
No, I don't. I'm sure some hot girls do.
I'd imagine so, yeah. Okay, so I DM a girl and say, what do I say?
The same thing you would say on Tinder.
Wait a second. Isn't this kind of becomes a volume game in a way? You just message something to every single, like 100 girls a night, and then at some will respond?
I mean, that's not my style, but maybe that's a strategy that might work.
Huh. Okay.
I don't know. I mean, I'm not saying. I'm mostly like, this is like,
Can we see your DM box anytime? How much for it to see the DM box of LaFord?
20,000.
Guys, I'm selling pieces to see LaFord's inbox box if anyone wants to buy a piece.
No, it's not something I engage in. It's not even something that's popular. I'm just saying I've heard about it. I know it happens. And what I'm saying is that it's difficult to get access to a lot of these very attractive girls nowadays, when they're getting so much of what they want, so much of the attention that they're looking for with social media. That's what I'm saying.
Hmm. I feel like just in regular life, like,
what's that?
I feel like in regular life in San Diego, there's like, I mean, there's literally an overly attractive girl everywhere. Like it's
perfect example. Who was I talking to the other day? I was on a date with a girl, I think. And she was like, oh, my friend got DM'd by Dan Bilzerian because he thought she was really hot, and now she parties with him.
Hmm.
For example, right? So now you have girls like that are just randomly in Toronto getting DM'd by people like Dan Bilzerian, and why would she want to be on Plenty of Fish or getting picked up by some loser drunk guy at a bar when she's getting DMs from, you know, millionaires? So, you know what I mean? Like, it's just the world's changing a bit, you know? That's all I'm saying. Dating is definitely changing.
This is all news to me, guys. I'm learning some new stuff today. I'm going to be filling out my Instagram profile. I'm going to be trying to GTO. What kind of techniques should we post photos on Instagram? I feel like I'm not playing at a... Yeah, Nicholas Burnett, you just said that, bro. Nicholas, before you said that, he said, come on, Joey, how do you think Dan Bilzerian gets all those girls? Most are from Instagram. Bang, bang. Nice job. Yeah, so if we're gonna GTO our Instagram profile with photos, like a description, what do you think? What do you think's the go-to?
Honestly, I don't know. I'm so past, like, I'm older than that generation. You know, I've learned that the guys that I met that are 25, like, they're doing something cool, and they just understand that it's like Instagram worthy. They just know, like, it's part of their daily routine. They know it's gonna make them look cool. They know how to edit the picture. They put it on Instagram, and they get really famous, you know. Like, and I'm just like learning. Like, the thing that I have learned about Instagram is you kind of need to have a niche. So, like, fitness, for example, is a good one. So if you're into going to the gym, you don't even need to be jacked. There are people that have 100,000 followers, but they post every day of stuff that they do at the gym, and they just over time gain followers. Lifestyle niches. Like, I know a guy that has a ton of followers, and most of his pictures are just shoes. He's huge into shoes, you know. There's like fashion, obviously. There's random like B-level, C-level athletes in Europe, like play like shitty soccer players who have like a million followers or whatever, you know, like just because they're huge into posting. A lot of it's lifestyle. Like, it's you just post stuff that, you know, or maybe you're into traveling or beautiful things or whatever. It's just posting stuff that people want to see. You know,
maybe I need to start DMing some of these girls and see if they're interested in coming on a podcast and talking about this.
There you go.
Maybe I should start a fucking Instagram podcast where I just talk to Instagram people that have a lot of followers and talk about what their life's like and what got them to this point of success. I'm not kidding. I'm serious. I'm about to go send some DMs. I'm hiring someone right now that would like to run the Poker Life Instagram page. And what you'll do is you'll message girls to come on the podcast. That's all I agree. That's all you do. Well, now we've learned a lot.
We've been here for a while.
I know. Well, you know, you just got into that sick, as believe it said, Lafort Podcast Part 7, Advanced IGG Strategy. So now you're now we're getting into some strategy. So,
I mean, like I said, I want to reiterate the fact that most of what I was talking about was like hype about something that's like kind of joking, but also kind of some truth to it. You know,
the word you're looking for is alleged.
I was exaggerating the fact that hot girls can only be picked up on Instagram. I'm just saying that it's definitely a thing now, and it's definitely more prevalent than it was. And I think it's changing some of the ways people connect. Let's say that.
Luke says IGG podcast would be boring as fuck. I disagree. I can make any podcast interesting. Let's not get carried away. Faden says, that reminds me, whatever happened in the stripper podcast? I'm going to be seeing the stripper / cam model in Vegas this summer, and well, I'm going to try to get her on a live podcast.
Let's do that.
Whoa, let's?
That'd be fun. I'm going to be there for 10 days. I want to do fun stuff.
Wait, you want to run a 3-man pot with the stripper?
A 3-man what? You cut out there.
You want to run?
Want to run a 3-man blah, 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 with a stripper?
You want to run a 3-man podcast with the stripper? Me, you, and the stripper.
Yeah, sure. Why not? It'd be fun.
All right, and then we can close it out and open ChatterBait after that, and then have an actual 3-way with the stripper on ChatterBait too. So, great. No,
I'm not touching that one.
Not gonna be able to do it. Okay. Yeah, I'm out. I'm in. I'm out. Okay. Ola says, "I wonder who I want as my father: Hollywood Haxton or Lafort." That's true. I'd still watch it. Yeah, plenty of people would watch that. Lafort, that's all I got. You got something else to add, Lafort? Jesus, man.
No, man, this has been a lot of fun. I hope people enjoyed it, even though I kind of went on some rants about things that they might not have wanted to hear about. But
mm-hmm. How do I figure out who you're following on Instagram?
What do you mean?
I can't look at your followers on Instagram. How does that work?
Yeah, you can.
How?
Click on my followers.
Oh, it's got to be on the app probably. Oh, who you're following, I'm saying.
Yeah, you can. Click on it.
Oh, I got to be on the app. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Instagram. What about the feminist? The feminist, she's actually going to be in Vegas too, believe it or not. And man, it's going to be a hot summer, man. It's going to be fun in Vegas. I feel like Vegas, I'm going to get somebody pregnant. And I'm just saying it right now. So that's why I'm retired. Okay. Don't be a bad influence on me. I'm retired. Please.
You just feeling extra fertile? Is that it?
I'm feeling like there might be too many occasions to potentially make some children in Vegas this summer. So.
All right. You're looking good. I mean, you're going to have a lot of attention for sure.
Oh, boy. For fuck's sakes, Lafort, calm down, man. Don't say things. I better put a mask on.
I like the hair. I like the style. I like your pretty eyes. You look good.
Thanks. Thank you, my friend. Guys, I don't even know what to do with myself right now. Is this what you say to the girls? Lafort, what did you do? What did you say to me, Lafort? That stripper is never stripping again after the 3-way podcast. No, she's a cam model too. Yeah, she does stuff on the internet too. The girl that I'm talking about. I'll send you her Twitter page.
All right. Cool.
That's it, guys in the chat. If you want to follow Lafort on Instagram, which apparently is the shit, / Lafortography, Lefortography on Twitter at, I don't even know what your Twitter name is, dude.
Lafortiments.
Lafortiments, of course. LDO, like, obviously. Lafortiments. Okay, Lafortiments on Twitter. You'll know you reached him if you see a guy with a shirt off. And the blog, your blog, your videos, lafortiments.wordpress.com. You can figure out all the fitness things he's wrote. You can see all the videos on his YouTube channel.
Yep.
And, I think that's all I got. I'm going to be back today, tonight or tomorrow. I'm going to get in my first World Series of Poker, WSOP Life 2015. It's going to be my first episode of that. I'm going to be covering the World Series of Poker in some type of way. I don't know how yet. And that's it. I don't have any other podcasts planned for exact dates, guys, coming up next week. So I'm not sure who I'm going to have on or when. I put out a lot of podcasts now. I'm a little tired. You know, maybe I'll take like a 2-day break and then I'll get back at it on Monday. But yeah, LaFort, anything else you want to add, puppy?
That's it, buddy. I look forward to seeing you in Vegas. You're going to be there the whole series or what?
I'm probably going to go in like a week or two. Probably like a week.
Okay.
I don't want to go for that long, but I also want to, once I go, I'm not going to leave. So I'm just going to go for
You will be there for the 24th.
For sure. Yeah, I'll be there. Yeah, definitely.
Beautiful. I'm in.
But yeah, my Instagram is Chicago Joey. E, so Joey with 1-2. I gotta make it more GTO. It's Joey with 2 Y's, so I gotta make it more GTO, I think.
Yeah,
but cool. Yeah, I'm still learning on Instagram, so that's it, man.
Try to get you some followers.
Yeah, how can we do that? How do I don't, I never used it before. I don't know how to get followers.
Oh, man, I'm still getting used to it, but there's ways to try to like boost other people and stuff like that.
Oh, well, we gotta boost you first.
What you need is you need like a celebrity to boost you, and then you're just gonna get like a ton of followers.
Well, I don't really. I feel weird. I don't like taking photos that often when I'm doing things, so I have to get over that. I hate taking photos.
That's exactly what Instagram is. So I feel like it might not be the app for you.
Yeah, I have a lot of self. Somebody told me I was playing bad because I have just pictures of myself on here. So I gotta look at the shirtless photo I put of myself. Oh yeah, you inspired me to put a shirtless photo on here. I forgot about that. Dude, these pictures are like 3 years old or more.
Work on it.
All right, man. I'm going to get after it. Before, thanks for tuning in, buddy. All right, thanks for being on. And guys in the chat. Hola, cola, moza, papito, a la cola, mamacita. That's all I got. Peace out.